transfer.
Rolling.
Just transferred like a lot of my boots that I don't use. Those shoes.
This is the first time I ever traded.
Successfully traded.
It's alright.
But the animation looks cool.
I'm in a Pokemon or a Golden Boy.
Well, yes, my favorite Pokemon, Golden Boy.
The first Batman movie, or not the first, my favorite Batman movie.
Holy shit, where'd you come from?
Probably yeah. My favorite, like, Batman piece of media is Return of the Joker. That's the Batman Beyond movie.
Oh, yeah, okay.
Now, I wouldn't recommend that any of you watch it.
Well, that's pretty usual.
Yeah. It's a pretty mediocre.
We were just talking about how you say that at work. It's so funny.
I mean, it's a pretty mediocre Batman movie. Most of what happens is Batman fights the Joker until the last 5 minutes. But the last 5 minutes really don't mean anything unless you've sat through the entire TV show. So I'm just going to give you kind of the basic lowdown. Batman Beyond takes place in the future. So it's like a cyberpunk Gotham City,
yeah,
right?
I know this guy. My friend.
Yeah. And Batman's old. Batman's like a 70-year-old fucker. Alfred is dead. And the entire Bat family has, like, abandoned Bruce. We don't know what happened, but something dark has happened in the past that has made all of them go, like, fuck Batman and leave him.
Yeah,
so he
Batman
is bitter and alone and in his house. Then he runs into this one, like, 18-year-old kid whose dad dies. And Batman, like, latches onto him, or Bruce at this point, latches onto him and really
Bruce.
Tries to live through him. Because he's too old to be Batman. He's like, you kid, you have to do it. You have to fight crime. And throughout the show, he's kind of whispering things in this kid's ear, right? You know, like, give up love, give up your personal attachments. One of the big overarching conflicts of the series is whether or not this kid, Terry, is going to give up his relationship or not to become Batman. And Bruce is, you know, constantly pressuring him to do it, right? And a really heartbreaking moment is when he's talking to his girlfriend, and, you know, they're kind of an upper-crust cyberpunk society, so they're staring down below. And she's talking about how sorry she feels for everyone down there. And he's like, what do you mean? They're a bunch of fucking drug-doing criminal scum. Because you're seeing the, like, toll that being Batman's taking on this kid. And, like, the kind of spirit he started with is slowly being corrupted. Another cool thing is throughout this show, he runs into old members of the Batman family. Like, he talks to an old Robin. He talks to Batwoman, who's now the commissioner of the police. And basically, they'll explain why Bruce is a bad person, and it's that he has this unquenching pain and desire to keep going, and he will turn everyone around and into tools to do his crusade, and he never figured out human connection. And another interesting thing Batwoman says to Terry is that I totally fucked Batman at one point. And that came out of nowhere when they were having coffee, and you're like, damn, okay.
Okay, but you still need to go. Sure, it would make the girl's heart melt.
What is that from?
Birds of Prey.
So anyways, the movie Return of the Joker. Oh, another thing worth mentioning. Is the camera still working?
Mm-hmm.
In this future, the Joker is dead. No one knows why or what happened. Something really fucked up happened now that Joker's gone. So in this movie, the Joker comes back. It turns out a long time ago, the Joker kidnapped Robin and, like, tortured him to make him his kid to, like, steal him from Batman. Yeah, he, like, bleaches his skin and, like, tortures him until his mind's blank and he can reprogram another person onto it.
I think I remember that.
From yeah.
The animated series.
Yeah.
Where fucking, was it Tim Drake?
Yeah, I think it was. Because this is canon in the animated series.
Yes.
And what ends up happening is Batman, you know, he can't bring himself to kill the Joker because he's a fucking bitch. And so he's about to die.
He is a little bitch.
Robin, who, like, the fucked up Robin, grabs the gun and breaks through the programming and kills the Joker.
Yeah.
But it turns out the Joker, because it's comics, programmed himself as an AI into Robin's brain and took him over from the inside out over the course of 20 years, slowly driving him insane and ruining his marriage for fun.
Batman.
Alright, so now Terry is fighting Batman, right? And Batman's telling him, you know, Joker likes to talk, you have to shut him out. And then Terry realizes that's why Batman could never beat Joker. Joker kept coming back because Batman never gave him the satisfaction of a laugh, and he kind of goes into Joker's Yeah, and he's like, wait a second. The Joker's projecting this really weird romance and image and duels him with Batman that doesn't exist. And so when Terry's fighting the Joker, he points out how you mean nothing to Batman. Batman's just an emotionally immature child who doesn't get jokes, and you're desperate and stupid and it's pathetic. And this gets in the Joker's head, and he throws a temper tantrum. And while he's throwing a temper tantrum, Terry kills him.
Fuck yeah.
Fuck yeah.
They don't really linger on this. But the way he gets rid of the Joker is, like, electrocuting the AI and short-circuiting it, which means he's dead. He's killed. Terry has done what Batman could never fucking do. Because Terry has become better than Batman, because Terry understands fucking emotional development.
Because he's Batman Beyond.
Yes.
Whoa.
And then after Joker dies, Bruce Wayne finally meets up with his old Bat family. You know, they're all old now, right? And they're hanging on the hospital belt, and now, like, this evil presence of the Joker's been eliminated through a Batman emotionally developing. It's like these people can come together as a family again. And it's so cute. And I think it's also a really cool message, because I feel like a common way in which we have to outgrow our fathers is becoming more emotionally developed. And so that was a cute little message. And that just goes to show, like, the thing I really like about Batman stories is when they look at Batman's flaws and do something with them. Because, like, Batman's a fucked up dude. I don't know, if you watch, like, a psychological Batman movie and come away wanting to be Batman, you've missed the point.
That's the point of Young Justice Season 1. That's the plot of Young Justice Season 1.
Yeah, but I feel like a lot of TV shows now take the vigilante thing too seriously, and they're like, what would it really like to be a vigilante? And that doesn't interest me too much, because I'm never going to do that. But what is it like to be emotionally obsessed with my crusade for justice and that to block out people in my life? That's a much easier thing to relate to. You know, it's more universal.
Wait, you guys seen a trailer for that new, like, Sylvester Stallone superhero movie?
What?
Which one?
Like he made, like, a metal suit for himself and he's going around because he has to fight crime or some shit. That's the part. That's the trailer I get on YouTube sometimes.
That's Black Daddy from Kick-Ass.
Yeah, but, like, not cool.
This poor, sad Sylvester Stallone. I hope he has a fun time making it.
I hope they put him in a funny little suit and they let him jump into a foam pit. And he does a Sylvester Stallone, he's like, wait!
I hope he knows where he is. I hope it's not like Harrison Ford, who's fucking
losing.
He peaked
in Spy Kids 3. I'm just gonna say that.
He peaked in Spy Kids 3.
He's in, like, Spy Kids?
No, he was the villain.
Was
he was the toy maker.
He was the toy maker.
I haven't watched his movie.
Bro, the shark guy in Suicide Squad, that was fucking sick.
Yeah, played
was that him also?
Yeah,
yeah, that was him.
Bored. He's in his Vin Diesel.
Oh, fuck.
Well, he's actually playing a character that looks cool.
But alright, so what our lecture today is actually going to be on is the Killing Joke comic. This is a very infamous Batman comic, and it was written by a wizard.
Yo.
The wizard's name is Alan Moore.
Shut the
Yo,
fuck
Alan
up about
Moore.
Alan Moore!
Alan
Shut
Moore's
the fuck
cool,
up
though.
About
Who's
Alan
Moore.
Moore.
Tell me about Alan Moore, Nyjah.
He is really good at Superman. He's pretty good at Superman. He's written a lot of shit, sort of. He also wrote The Watchmen.
Yeah.
The Watchmen. Everyone.
So, in case you're wondering who's watching The Watchmen, it's Alan Moore.
I just, like, read a video about, like,
but he's,
watched a video about Dr. Manhattan recently. Oh my god.
He's
crazy.
Good at Superman, and therefore he's pretty good at a lot
Whatever
of
Happened
characters.
To the Man of Tomorrow? Banger.
Fucking banger, actually. He wrote The Watchmen, which was like, hey guys, let's imagine superheroes without Superman.
And then everyone's like, what if Superman said fuck?
What if Superman had...
No, no.
It's not Superman, it's Captain Atom! But, yeah.
And then we got The Boys.
And then we...
Yeah.
Dude, I'm on season... I just got on season 1.
You know what? I'm
season.
Gonna fucking say
the
it.
The Boys show is better than
the
comic by miles.
He's so fucking right! The Boys show is
the comic,
be better
the
than
the comic.
The
comic is literally just, like, the guy jerking off about how much he hates superheroes. But in
yeah.
the comics, it's like an actual... In the show, it's like an actual
The comics
story.
Makes fun of care about of people that don't exist. Like, oh my god, what if we... the boys, the comic makes fun of a group of people that just don't fucking exist. Like, no one's on that level. The boys' comic is just setting up pins to knock them down.
With okay. In defense of the boys' comic.
Shut the fuck up.
No.
You're wrong.
No.
The boys' show is released on fucking Amazon Prime to a mainstream audience, right?
And you know what? It still works.
It does, yeah. The boys' comic was not expected to be that big of a hit. It was for people who read a shit ton of superhero comics.
For people that read Alan Moore and are wrong.
Yeah, and so, I mean, yes, it is unnecessarily edgy and I can't really sit through it. But I kind of appreciate, like, the trope deconstruction, especially when that was less ubiquitous, and watching it be that horrific and fun. I could see picking up reading that and going, ha ha ha, yeah, that is kind of cool. I don't think it was meant to be this epic story, three-season saga that we now understand it to be.
Fair. Alright.
Perhaps. Doesn't excuse it sucking, though.
Let's talk about how Homelander can get watched by every other superhero.
Literally, Homelander is only powerful in comparison. He is relatively powerful. Like any other big guy character from any other superhero movie.
Not even big guy, like literal children. Like Steven can fold him.
Steven Universe fucking put a dead Homelander.
Do y'all know Alan Moore's Swamp Thing?
Yes.
I heard it was good. I haven't checked it out.
It's Alan Moore. It's as good as everything else.
Yeah.
I just wanted to play catch.
He also did the Miracle Man comic, where Miracle Man tries to explain to humanity that money doesn't exist, and he's trying to, like, destroy it for us.
Didn't he do, like, a kid president thing, or is that someone...
Alan Moore probably did a kid president thing, because I don't know, he's kind of like that.
He fucking did Speed.
I'm getting mixed up with Neil Gaiman, never mind.
Yeah. I don't think Alan Moore did Speed.
Speedball.
Oh my god.
I'm saying, who did Speedball?
I do not know.
Because I feel like Speedball like, also fits into one of the deconstructions that we could talk about one day.
Haven't read it. But anyway, so Alan Moore is a self-proclaimed wizard, and Killing Joke is a spell. So let's talk about this. The basic idea is that all art is spellcasting, because you, like... So I'm gonna say the word penis, right? Dr. Manhattan's big cock, and you all think of that penis on Dr. Manhattan, right?
The Manhattan's blue penis!
Yes!
Yeah.
I am the guy that was on the Blizzard design team!
That was a spell I just cast on all of you.
I took, like, 10 d6 psychic damage.
Yeah.
11 d6 psychic damage.
It took a year off my life.
Let's do some real... psychic damage. Darth Vader. You're thinking of him. Picture him. I need you to do me. But isn't it crazy that I can make a sound with my mouth and cause a picture to appear in all of your heads, and it's the same picture pretty much in all of your heads?
Yeah.
Cast sending, what the fuck?
Well, as far as we know, you can't,
well,
it's
yeah.
impossible to perceive how
there's
other people picture this.
Maybe Dr. Manhattan's car is in his mind.
Or if there's like an actual rooster.
Yeah, he's got Mars chickens and he's...
And so the general idea is if you read a good story, Alan Moore keeps saying the point of his spells is to quote-unquote transform consciousness, and I'm not quite sure what exactly he means by that, but I think it's just the general, you know how you kind of feel better after you consume a good piece of art?
Yes.
Yeah.
He's restoring psychic damage, he's undoing it.
Yeah, like,
your trauma.
I think in the beginning that's all he was trying to do. Once he gets later in his career, he gets fucking insane. He wrote a comic with the purpose to end the world. And I was like, okay, what? I was trying to figure out what the hell this means. I don't think this guy's crazy. I think he's just smarter than me. And he keeps saying that once the way everyone understands the world changes, the world ends, and this comic is gonna, like, revolutionize the spirit... chakra some shit.
And what was it?
I don't know, it didn't go anywhere. Like, it was like a 13-issue thing about this lady running around the surreal library and demons were showing up and stuff, and it didn't make any sense, and it didn't do well. But anyways, Alan Moore is crazy, and he does some cool stuff. But he says Killing Joke is the biggest mistake of his career. He considers that a miscast spell. A piece of magic that was too powerful and went wild.
This shit fizzled on him.
And I kind of want to explore this deeply failed spell of Alan Moore's.
I feel like every other one of Alan Moore's spells fizzles.
What the fuck do you mean? Watchmen!
No, I'm saying, like, it's an imprecise cast because it only hits, like, 50% of the time.
Oh, that's true. Yeah.
He's casting high-level spells, but you don't pass the intelligence check.
Oh, he did V for Vendetta, if you all know that shit. Yes, he did fucking V for Vendetta. He did the fucking I hate George... I guess he didn't... The movie was about hating George Bush. The comic was about hating the Republican British people.
Yeah.
British.
Fucking British.
Anyways, so to really get into this miscast spell, I'm just gonna start with a basic summary of the Killing Joke.
Hell yeah.
So Batman's driving 80 miles an hour. He is looking dead ahead. He breaks into Arkham Asylum. He walks straight in. He's walking past all of his nemesises. The Riddler, the fucking Two-Face, the Penguin, he doesn't give a fuck. He walks past the security guards. He walks right to Joker's cell. Commissioner Gordon's waiting for him. He hands him a coffee. He goes, "Hey, Batman, do you want to tell me what's going on here?" Batman doesn't respond. He walks into the cell. He sits right in front of Joker. He stares at him dead in the eyes. "I think we need to talk about our relationship, me and you, and where this is going."
And then the counselor walks in.
Yeah.
Couples therapy.
He goes on to say how, like, we have this really fatal relationship and how one of us is going to end up dying, and I don't want it to be like that. I feel like we can connect. We can stop this. And there's this really weird sexual undertone.
Like Kenny's funny?
Yeah. It's very, like, Batman's getting emotional, and he's talking about his relationship with this man, you know, and their connection and their future together, and how he wants their future together to look happy, and it's
gay.
It is gay. It is very gay. And then Batman grabs Joker's face.
Oh my god.
And then he looks at his hand and sees makeup is all over his hand. And that this is not the real Joker. He's confessed all of his feelings to a fake. And so now he's grabbing the guy by the neck and slamming on the ground and screaming,
forget.
"Do you know he fucking let free? Where the fuck is it?" And so now Commissioner Gordon is hearing Batman beat this innocent man outside of the cell. And it's like, bro, stop. And then Batman runs away. Okay, so Joker's on the loose, right? It turns out Joker's big plan is to kidnap Commissioner Gordon's, or shoot Commissioner Gordon's daughter.
Then.
Like, in the rib, so she's alive but crippled. Then take all of her clothes off, and do this in front of her father.
Doing her dirty in front of her dad.
And then knock her father out. Then he gets out a picture, and, like, while he's beating and stripping Commissioner Gordon's daughter, Barbara, he's taking pictures of her. And depending on your reading of the comic, he sexually assaults her. Alright, then he kidnaps Commissioner Gordon, puts him in this, like, carnival hell ride, like, haunted horror things, and then projects images of his daughter naked, abused, and being, like, hit by him and his, like, clown goons all around him while he sings songs and has little, like, midget people put ropes around his neck and scream and yank him.
Oh my fucking god, we love the gore porn.
I know the fucking song. Fuck you.
We love gore porn inflicted upon the female body.
Yeah, we're gonna get way more into that, but... Also, something worth noting, comics were not like this back then. At all. In the 90s, especially after Watchmen, comics slowly started getting more and more degenerate and violent, to where now this is something you'd kind of expect Joker to do. But back at this time, like, I don't know, the idea of Red Hood, or Red Arrow doing drugs was, like, groundbreaking, you know? So all of a sudden Joker is fucking arresting and putting pictures up and cutting people's eyes out, and it's fucking horrifying. You know? And the reason Joker's doing this is because he wants to drive Commissioner Gordon mad. He wants to prove that everyone is only one day away from being like him. And if he makes someone have a day as horrible as he did, they will become the Joker like he does. So he's like doing shit to Gordon, right? And Batman comes to stop him. And Batman like effortlessly takes down all of his goons and destroys his parade and rescues Gordon. And then he goes up to Joker and is like, dude, I don't want to fight. I just want to talk to you, please. I want this to work. Please, I don't want to kill you. I don't want that on my hands. I don't want you to kill me. And maybe it's not too late. You don't have to go back to Arkham. You can come with me and I can teach you. We can get you the help. You don't have to be alone. And then the Joker pauses and says, no, it's too late for that.
Damn!
And then, throughout this comic, Joker has been, like, reflecting on his past, and this is the first comic that gives, like, an attempt at the Joker's origin story. So, what the Joker, originally the Joker was, like, a guy who worked at a chemical plant, right? And this was, like, in the 1940s or some shit.
Yeah, no really.
And he hated it. Every day, in and out, it made him depressed as fuck, and he was like, you know what, I'm gonna quit and become a comedian. But he wasn't funny. He was like a really socially awkward guy. And then his wife got pregnant. And then he was like being late on bills and the stress was piling up. And then he knew he needed to go back to work, but he couldn't do that to himself again. He had to be an artist and that was slowly killing him. Right? And so then he is home and he screams at his wife about it and basically abuses her. And then he says, oh, I'm sorry for taking it out on you. And she goes, it's fine. I'm happy with this. You're good in the sack, so who cares? Alright, so then he goes meets with some mobsters, and they say, remember that chemical plant you worked in? If you help me break into it again, we'll help, we'll give you enough money to put your wife up in, like, a safe neighborhood, and you'll be okay. So while he's talking to the gangsters, the police come by and let him know that his wife and the baby inside of her died in a freak fire accident in the house. And so he's like, fuck, well, I guess I don't need to do this anymore. And the criminals are like, no, you do. And so he goes in and yada, yada, yada. Batman stops him and shoves him in a pool of acid. And then he becomes the Joker.
He got Jokerfied in the Joker.
Yo, the Joker sauce!
So then the Joker, right before, right after he says it's too late, he gets the same nervous look he used to get before he told jokes when he was bad as a comedian. And he begins to stutter. And he tells a joke to Batman, and he said, you know, there were two crazy men in the sane asylum, and eventually they decided, you know, they didn't like that anymore, so they were going to escape. And one of them got on the roof, and he jumped onto the other building. But the other guy, he was scared, he couldn't jump. And so the guy who made it over, guy one, right, he said, don't worry, I've got a flashlight, so I'll send it, I'll turn it on, and you'll just walk across the beam. And the other guy said, are you fucking crazy? You'll just turn it off when I'm halfway through. And of course, that's a really silly metaphor for the Joker and Batman's relationship. Where, of course, these are two horribly mentally ill people who are trying to help each other. Joker's trying to show Batman that everyone's insane and you just need to let go. And Batman's trying to help Joker by letting him become orderly. And how it's all so fucking pointless. And then Batman begins to laugh. And then Batman kills the Joker.
Oh.
Now, interpretations differ on this. Because comics have this weird continuity thing, Alan Moore wasn't allowed to kill off the Joker. So he does it poetically. Batman and Joker are both laughing, and then Batman, like, kind of gets physical with the Joker and grabs him, but he's also kind of grabbing his neck. And then we cut to the puddle, and then only one of them is laughing. And then Batman just keeps laughing, and then it's silence. Batman killed the Joker because he saw that, like, this is the end. This relationship can't work. So, I don't know, I thought that was a pretty cool comic. It's a really short read. It's also really fucking problematic. I think we the term that I hear used to describe this trope is usually fridging, where you take a female character and
not just female. You can fridge the fuck out of anyone.
Yeah, but it started.
It's mostly females.
Green Lantern movie.
I've generally, yeah, started as a Green Lantern thing. And I've generally heard it used in feminist critiques. But yeah, you can fridge anyone. Where you kill off the character pretty much for the sake of killing them for shock value, and you disrespect their purpose in the story, and then you shove them off. there were only two female characters in the story. One of them is only there for Joker to brutalize for the sake of adding, I don't know, darkness to the narrative, right? And then the other female character is only there to be killed off to make Joker's story sad. But I also want to point out, one of the things this comic does really well is the art is so fucking intentional. When Alan Moore was writing the directions for this comic, he was like, Tennessee Williams, a crazy man. He had three paragraphs of description for every fucking panel. When Batman is first talking to the Joker about their relationship, he's framed in the bars of the cell, and Joker's framed in a different one, like they're trapped in this dualistic relationship. When we first see Gordon, who's stressing out about the fact that Joker escaped again, we see that his room is covered in bottles of alcohol, but it's not just bottles of alcohol. They're different brands of alcohol, because Gordon is a connoisseur, and Alan Moore wrote what each of bottle alcohol would be because he cares about that fucking shit, because it was that detailed, and that's really cool.
I need to know what Commissioner Gordon's drinking schedule is like.
I mean, if you lived in Gotham, it'd probably be pretty fucking horrible.
We're at 25 minutes, by the way. It's still going.
Oh, cool.
But the red battery is...
Alright, we should probably cut.
Cool.
Unfortunately. Rolling.
Alright, so that's the killing joke. Does everyone get the general gist of that?
Yeah.
I did not get the joke, unfortunately.
It didn't kill you?
No.
Well, the joke is, the killing joke is the joke that Joker told the Batman that made him realize that he needed to kill him.
Yeah.
The killing joke.
Yeah.
So, in 2016, they decided to make a movie of this.
Hey, I remember seeing the trailer for that fucking everywhere.
They
yeah.
Did? Why aren't you laughing?
Well, because this was like 2016, and the DC universe was in a really bad spot at this point. does anyone remember Batman vs. Superman?
Yes.
Yeah. Well, no, it's crazy, because I remember, like, being, like, a mild fan of Superman and Batman way before that, because, like...
Can you train on that?
Because, like, I remember Batman Brave and the Bold was on Cartoon Network.
Yeah!
And I was like, whoa, Batman's cool, actually, even though he doesn't have powers. Because my whole hang-up was like, Batman can't walk through walls, disappear, and fly. What makes him more unique than the other guys? So, and then Superman could do all of that, but that was it. And I was like, man, these are boring. And then I was like, oh, wait a second, they're actually cool characters. And then Zack Snyder came around and then just sort of, like, scrubbed them down and made them... like, I don't know, like, dark, edgy, wannabe Shadow the Hedgehog figures, I guess.
Yeah!
And I was like, wow, I hate Superman and Batman. And then it isn't until recently where I was like, no, wait, I love Superman and Batman. I just hate Zack Snyder.
Honestly, he's suffering from the killing joke spell. Because the killing joke is one of the original comics that really taught people that darkness sells in comics. Because the media, or, like, the target audience for superhero comics was, like, young men in their, like, late teens and 20s, and we were angry fucks who wanted to read about rape and sexual assault on female bodies.
Yep.
And so they realized that sold, and so they kept doing it and doing it and doing it, and then the 90s happened, and then we got the fucking DCEU, where they realized that making the tone of the movies darker was good for some reason, and they lost a shit ton of money and all critical respect, and...
Suicide Squad, wow, bro.
So you saying we some kind of...
And that's just how they were fucking up their live-action movies. They hadn't had a hit in the animated universe since Red Hood in 2010.
Like, the only time the DC animated universe, like, blew up, I guess, was when it was revealed that, what's his face? Constantine was fucking King Shark.
Yes.
And that was the only time I saw, like, relevant.
That shit was on Tumblr.
And that was queer baiting to Tumblr because they knew that was their only hope of relevance. They were so desperate.
They're like, holy shit.
Yeah, that was like the only
Holy shit,
route.
Batman, we gotta make it queer!
They introduced basically a new Robin, Damian Wayne, who is comics, so it is Batman's son, because Ra's al Ghul stole Batman's semen and impregnated his daughter with it, so he could have a son. Yes, and then Bruce adopted him. And he's a whiny bitch, and nobody likes him. There's like three movies about him. And then they were like, we're sorry, we're sorry, we're sorry. No more Damian Wayne. You like the Killing Joke, right? Okay, cool. We'll get Mark Hamill. You guys like Mark Hamill? And Kevin Costner? And they got like half the animated series cast back for this shit.
Tyler, are you telling me that art produced only with the intent of making money is not good?
Answer quickly.
No, it's great. That's the only art I consume.
Bro, can't wait for that AI art shit to take off. That I don't have to do anything.
What do you mean, Ed? This is Sonic 2. This is the writing process for...
Sonic 2 got it. Sonic, no, we're not doing this now. I'm not talking your spells. Your mind games.
Yeah, don't cast fucking spells on us.
Bro, I'm casting spells all the fucking time.
Stop it.
Alright, so, one of the big questions was, so you're adapting The Killing Joke, right? This
yeah.
is 2016, feminist critiques in nerd culture is a big thing. How are you gonna address, you know, that? And they said, don't worry about it, because this is not gonna be straight adaptation. We're gonna add a 30-minute film beforehand that's gonna add Batwoman's perspective,
Ooh.
You know, to make this okay. Barbara is actually Batwoman, as it turns out.
Oh, that's...
Fun fact, because of comics' horrible continuity thing, when Barbara Gordon got, like, her knees broken by Joker, Batwoman was out of commission. And so they had her become Oracle, so she got to be, like, the woman in the chair. Because we can't have a woman as Robin fighting crime, right?
Stephanie Brown.
Is that, Dark Knight Returns?
Fuck, I don't remember.
Old Batman and the young one with, like, the really cool haircut.
I remember she was blonde.
Okay. Whatever the case. So the movie opens with Batgirl running around, and she is fighting a new criminal. Paris.
No, like, the state? Country?
Wait, like...
The guy?
A new
criminal.
Oh my
god, like, Kanye?
France.
His name is Paris Franz.
Oh my fucking god.
Yeah, right? Really creative name here. And he's like a mobster, and he has a very Joker attitude. He feels like Joker ripoff. Because he kind of tries to do the laugh and has the energy, and he's almost there, but not quite. And he's running around doing petty crimes, like fucking stealing jewels and shit, right? So Batwoman stops him, and then he like hones in on her, and he's like, I love you, Batwoman. Do you want to hang out with me? I have a present for you. And so Batman intercepts these messages, and he's like, no, this is bad. He tries to, like, father figure block her from fighting him. And then Batwoman is like, you know, you can't keep treating me like a kid. Why do you always do this? And she gets really mad at him, and Batman tries to put himself in the way.
Oh, I think I've seen this, actually.
Something in the way. Oh my god!
Yeah.
Like the Nirvana song.
Like the Nirvana song.
Bless you.
Thank you.
And then Batwoman really tries to express, you know, I'm not a little girl anymore. And so she attacks him, and they start fighting. And this turns into a sex scene where she pulls out Batman's bat cock.
Oh my fucking
not
god.
Not his bat cock! Come on!
She
yeah.
beats him in the fist fight, shoves him on the ground, rips open his cod piece, and they fuck.
Mommy!
Man.
Not his bat cock! If
All right.
Batman was trans, he'd keep his strap on his utility belt. That's all.
Alright, so then Batman gets really awkward and refuses to talk to her. And
I
it,
would too, if I'm
yeah.
Batman.
Oh, and another thing to mention, this entire thing, Batwoman is talking about her relationship to Batman with her gay best friend at the library.
Naturally.
And
oh, yeah.
Oh, the gay best friend.
Yeah, and his only purpose is to sit there and go, and I thought the gay scene was complicated. Ha ha, did you know I'm gay?
Hey, hey guys, guess what? Penis.
But he was also, like, wearing a fucking sweater vest or something, and his voice was like...
My favorite thing is his opening line is like, you know, Barbara, I don't see why you're having fishing trouble when there's so many fish in the sea. And it pans around him to, like, looking at men. And it's the most basic stock, like, male character image. It's the same body shape as all the other guys in the animated universe. It's like, damn, these authors really have no ability to conceptualize men as sexy, do they?
Would you have preferred if he was, like, thin and willowy and, like, Harley Quinn, but for men?
I don't know, I just feel like they're very good at remembering to give every woman really big boobs in the play of the sex appeal, but the idea of a man being sexy and a man finding that sexy, no, it's the stock image in the background. I thought that was funny.
Thank you for tonight, Kaiki.
But anyways, so she decides, Batman says, you know, you're off this case, you're done, we'll talk later. And she goes, fuck it, I'm gonna stop friends on my own. So she catches up with Paris, and she beats the shit out of him, almost killing him. And then Batman kinda shows up, gives her the, like, I'm disappointed in you look, and stops her. And while she's beating up Paris, she's screaming, you ruined everything! Fred! Because, you know, she wanted to be with Batman, and somehow she blames Paris for breaking up that relationship. But while... And then after this, Batgirl says, you know, Batman, I'll save you the trouble, I'll break up, I'm taking off the costume, and they leave. And this is what happens directly before the story of Killing Joke. So remember in the beginning of Killing Joke when Batman all of a sudden, like, needs to see Joker for no reason? Like, he's just suddenly going to talk about this relationship thing? This gives a really weird context for it. Batman watched Batgirl beat up her version of Joker, and all of a sudden he had to talk to his Joker. He broke up with Batgirl. What I'm trying to say is the reason Batman saw Joker is because he was horny. That's what's implied here.
His Batcock was already whipped out.
Yeah, Batman's horrible sexual repressed energy. And I also kind of want to point out something I kind of think, there's sexual tension between Batman and all of the Robins.
Oh,
you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like,
you shut the fuck up about Nightwing, you shut the fuck up about Nightwing.
Kid with little short pants, running out, treating like an adult, very physical activities together.
Robin's a twink.
Remember that thing Posner said about how he played Robin and they specifically
yes.
asked him to be as effeminate and homosexual as they possibly could?
Yes. Oh, and in the Holy Musical Batman.
Holy Musical Batman!
But Batman wouldn't. Batman is homophobic. Batman will not fuck a guy. The way I'm kind of reading the story,
Robert Pattinson,
right?
Batman would.
Probably. But the Batgirl kind of tapped into this repressed sexual energy that Batman's had with his companions for fucking years, which is kind of why this is so breaking, and he goes to the... When he really wants to deal with this aspect of himself, he goes to the only adult, real adult love interest he has anymore, which is the Joker, which is a homosexual relationship.
But also the Joker's, like, on the same level as him.
Yeah, that's...
He can't fuck anyone normal. Like,
yeah.
I think his only other option within the Justice League would be the Flash. No.
Wait, why do you think Batman and the Flash would fight?
Because the Flash has a weird chokehold on Batman that none of the other members of the JL have, and it's actually, like, mentioned a few times how the Flash can saunter his fruity ass into the Watchtower and be like, hey, Batman, I have a Flash appreciation ceremony if you want to come. And Captain Atom and Peacemaker will be in the fucking background like, hey, what the fuck? And then Batman will be like, what time do you want me there? Flash
is
the only one that gets away with that. I can't remember the name of it, but it's a whole thing in which there are supervillains trying to kill the Flash specifically.
Gotcha.
And Batman pulls out every stop to keep him alive.
That's really funny.
Like, he's like, you're not allowed to leave my sight, you stay on my left side, and then because the Flash is wild and free and can't be caged, he doesn't like when the boy toy starts toying with him, so he's like constantly trying to run away and get away from it all. But he's disobeying him, he's being sassy, and Batman keeps, like, being like, the Flash, you can't go out on your own, I'm worried about you, bud. They get kidnapped by another version of Batman, who Batman immediately gives up. He's like, I can't beat myself. I know myself. And then the Flash breaks out and he's like, but who can anticipate you, Flash? Listen, if it was anyone, it would be him. Shut the fuck up about Superman.
No, I agree.
He's got different bitches, okay? And Wonder Woman pegs all of them.
Going in a weirder, similar direction. Another really cool thing that this short film at the beginning adds is that the Joker beats Batgirl, right? Originally, it was just to get at Batman through getting at Jim Gordon. But this time, I kind of think it's because Batman fucked her. Because Joker has canonically in this been out for a while now. He only resurfaces after Batman has sex with Batgirl. You know, it kind of adds that, like, jealousy level to it.
How would he know, though?
Was he there at the fucking microphone? Like...
Joker fucking knows everything, man. But also, I feel like on a symbolic level, you know, the reason this darkness happened to Batman is because he broke this barrier and fucked her, and now Joker had to get that revenge.
Hold.
Anakin approaches the Senator's chamber.
Before he enters, she feels him, his force grabbing every muscle.
Every muscle. Tensing. Massaging. Padme's entire body pulsing in soft ecstasy.
Completely under Anakin's control. Sometimes, she felt like Anakin was still a little boy, but not tonight. He would protect her, no matter the cost.
Alright, so... someone else want to hold this?
Yeah!
We can talk about the Karma Sutra after.
Fuck. I'm okay. Is it recording?
Is it? Does it have a little red dot?
A little red dot, yeah.
Okay, cool, yeah, it's recording. Is the time going up on that?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's recording. Okay, so I really like, so Batgirl beats up her version of the Joker, right?
Yeah.
And then, karmically, Joker beats her up almost as bad. And also, Batgirl is pining for a relationship with Batman, but Batman refuses because that's just not his way.
Dakota water.
Batman is pining with a relationship with the Joker. He begs him, please, let's make this work. And Joker says, no, it's too late for that. Just like Batman with Batgirl. I don't know, it adds this kind of cool karmic flow. It makes more sense. And there's also so much fucking sexual energy in here. Batman is one sexually repressed fuck. And...
as am
okay.
I.
Okay.
Same Batman.
I mean... y'all were in California, right?
Yeah.
Prostitution's legal in Nevada as long as you're not in Carroll County.
We were in Sacramento.
Yeah, that's kind of
I know where we're going next time, though.
Or Australia.
Let's go!
Australia, like, is really, like, chill about that shit.
And it's safe in Australia.
I'm pretty sure it's, like,
America.
Government regulated.
Yeah.
Where you gotta get your prostitute.
My government sanctioned prostitution out of the way.
Every prostitute has to get, like, HIV tested and all that
stuff.
Shit, and
man,
I think
that's
here's.
Pretty dope.
Yeah.
That's
and they get rights. Like, you can't get away with.
Like, how we're talking, like, prostitutes are, like, a different species.
They have.
They get rights.
That's
I mean,
a good
you
point.
Can't just, like, American businessman them, so that's pretty cool. They get rights.
But anyway, so. There's a lot of sexual energy around Batman. And I think part of the reason for that... actually, this reminds me of a paper I read for film school. So... have you guys seen the movie Drive or Baby Driver?
Yeah,
no.
Baby Driver, fuck
I
yeah.
I have not. I don't even know what that is.
Love Baby Driver, oh my god.
I need to watch it.
Do you know Drive?
No.
Okay. basically, those... movies both trace their roots back to one movie that came back into the 70s that is about a really stoic, angry getaway driver who only says, like, 100 words of dialogue in the entire film.
Damn.
And the essay argued that the reason that film was so successful and the reason we keep remaking it and do stuff like Baby Driver and Drive still, the reason we love this quiet getaway driver character is because it's evolving out of the 1940s detective. And the 1940s detective is, like, defined by their potential energy, right? Because they're repressed, they're angry, but they're contained. That is the 40s detective, you know? But there's no outlet for all of that anger. There's, like, maybe a gunshot at the end or a crime being solved, but that doesn't feel fun. The essay argued that car driving is the true sexual release of the potential energy.
The true sexual release. Copyrights.
I don't know, that sounds like some shit an academic would say, but does that make vague sense?
Yes.
Yeah.
Especially because driving is such a masculine-coded activity.
Is it?
Yes.
No, yeah, I know.
No, mean, car culture is a masculine culture thing,
Queen,
you know?
We made a whole song about wanting to fuck.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, that was Roger Taylor specifically.
Yeah, yeah, Roger Taylor.
Yeah.
He wanted to fuck his car.
Oh my god, they have a whole part in the movie. They have a whole part in the fucking Bohemian Rhapsody movie where they talk about that.
You're
that's
like,
just...
bro, you want to fuck your car?
Yeah.
But yeah, you know, and I feel like Batman is like that, but on steroids, because driving a car is masculine and all, but like, fucking jumping through blowing up buildings and punching the Joker feels way more masculine.
Yeah.
Like, I feel so fucking pumped when I'm playing Arkham Asylum and I'm the fucking Batman and I'm beating the shit out of the Riddler and I'm fucking jumping out of shit. It's cool, you know? But at a certain point, I feel like it does. Batman relies on the fact that I'm so stoic and pressed in and that I release through this action. And the Killing Joke is not an action-heavy story, you know? Like, the action where Batman fights all the goons to get to Joker is, like, inconsequential, because the story is about him and Joker's relationship. We don't even see Barbara Gordon get beat. We get to see her get shot. It's more about relishing in the horror of it, so there's no real release in that story, if that makes sense. So watching Batgirl suddenly push Batman down and fuck him, I don't know, it adds an epicenter to the story I feel like it was always missing. This is my defense of the Killing Joke movie. This is generally hated. 36 in Rotten Tomatoes.
Yeah.
The reason everyone hates it is because they were like, we're gonna fix the feminist problems with this comic. And they fixed none of them and added a scene where Batgirl fucked Batman.
Oh.
You know?
Oh, yeah. I see the problems now.
Darth Vader choked his wife to death. Violence against female bodies is a really fun, recurring theme. Rape culture. It sells. And even though I feel like Batman fucking Batgirl was a cool scene, I feel like the way Batman throws her away and is kind of like rewarded for it.
It like was Batman a cool just goes, scene.
I don't know, I feel like it does still throw away the woman character, and they add this gay guy for no reason.
This gay guy for no reason.
Like, the movie has its failures. And the gay main point especially. I wanted to come across with this lecture is, you're not going to see Batcock this good anywhere else, and Jesus. I think it's worthwhile. But I think there was... Yeah, there was one other thing I wanted to mention. So, you know how Alan Moore is a wizard?
Yes.
Well, there's another famous comic writer who's a wizard, who in fact likes to fight Alan Moore. He's convinced he's in a wizard duel with Alan Moore.
Oh?
Contenders.
He wrote a comic as a counterspell to Watchmen.
What was that?
To nullify, I don't remember. It's not good.
Damn, I guess it didn't work.
You know how Watchmen has, like, three panels of three?
Yeah.
This one was trying to contain its energy, so it was four panels of four.
Oh, my God.
And this fucker is named Grant Morrison.
Yeah, he sounds familiar.
He's pretty good. He's written some solid shit. Do you know All-Star Superman?
Yeah.
Do you know the one where there's Owl Batman and there's like two universes?
Yeah,
Doomer Batman.
Yeah. So, he likes to think of superheroes as modern mythology.
Oh, yeah, makes sense.
Yeah, I can see that.
They're like gods in a sense.
Yeah, because he's like the Justice League to us is
gods
like the Greek
us.
Gods to Greeks. We're just smart enough to not literally believe in them anymore. But their adventures are still solid, and something cool about it is we have all these collective
rock
people
solid.
Writing Batman, right? There is no Batman storyteller. And there's no real Batman canon either. You know, every Batman story is kind of as real as another. And all Batman stories also take place in this mythic universe of, like, You know Batman has fought these villains before, right? You know he's met Superman. You know he's done all these things. You don't know the exact specifics when you hear the story, but you get the general sense.
Mm-hmm.
There is this mythic Gotham. When I say the DC universe is kind of like Once Upon a Time.
Yeah.
And also, when you tell a story good enough, when you cast a spell powerful enough, that becomes a permanent part of the character's story. You know, like how The Killing Joke, everyone generally considers that canon the Batman now because the story was so good.
Mm-hmm.
And so the goal of a Batman mage is to discover, like, because you're not really writing, you're discovering, right? Because you're playing with gods, you're playing with archetypes, you're wiping off the sands. And so your goal as a Batman mage is to find a new part of Batman. Alan Moore also talks about, he likes to think of magic, all magic is language, and it's different systems of language, and he believes, like, the Greek pagan gods, that's an alphabet. You know, because there's only one god, but the Greek gods are different manifestations and aspects of it. And if you are, he hates Christians, because, you know, if you do enough acid, I feel
who
like you're just going to start hating the Bible.
Who doesn't?
And he was saying how the problem with Christianity, right, is that we all believe in one God, and that's like we have one note. Like, we're looking at God and screaming the same note over and over and over. He's fucking tired of us when there's so many flavors of God to speak and understand. And, you know, so, like, pagan gods, cosmologies of the universe, those are all alphabets. And so the Justice League, in the same sense, is an alphabet. And it's an ever-evolving and developing alphabet, as in the Grant Morrison angle, we're discovering more of it. And this is all to say, I feel like this Killing Joke movie has definitively proven to me that Batman is sexist. I think it's discovered. I think the soul of Batman is... I think Batman is a piece of shit. I mean, I think he is gay. I think he hasn't come to terms with it. And
that makes him a piece of shit.
And I think...
Fuck you for being closeted, Batman. My God.
Well, I don't know. I feel like there's also something of... Obviously, Batgirl consented to the sex because she initiated it, right?
Mm-hmm.
But he was not emotionally ready for that, and he did not fully communicate what that sexual act was going to mean. And Batman has trouble expressing his emotions, and that's because of the very thing that makes him good. You know, Batman worships the stoicism.
No.
In, like, Western culture, there is this... It started with the Greeks, this basic idea of you need to conquer all of your emotions, right?
Like Shadow the Hedgehog.
Yeah. Like, we all feel desires. Like, I want to rape and murder people all the time, right? Not really. Basic idea. Greek world, right? Are you wearing a shadow?
He is!
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. What does it say?
Is that the fucking Slipknot font?
It just says Shadow.
That's the fucking Slipknot font! Oh my God. And straight out of 2001.
My base instincts are
is
evil,
holding
right?
A gun?
Yeah.
But not only are my base instincts evil, they're irrational, they're stupid. If I follow my base instincts, I'm not going to be happy. So I have to quiet my emotions and become logical and act like a pure, logical, rational male. And if I do that enough, I'll achieve true, basically, enlightenment. And I think that's a really fucking unhealthy philosophy that we're just finally starting to deconstruct, like, these generations in the last 100 years. Because it leads to really toxic masculinity. You know, it leads to deadening your emotions and rewarding yourself for doing that. And you know who's fucking guilty of that? Like, fucking crazy? Bruce McFucking Wayne.
Bruce McFucking Wayne.
Yeah.
Bruce thinks he's better than everyone else because he's smarter than them, because he acts more logically than them, because he's more closed off than them, which is why everyone fucking leaves him in the Batman Beyond universe, and he's unable to reconnect with them until Batman's son, Terry, kills Joker by becoming more emotionally intelligent.
Batman has a kid?
He does, but I meant his trainee.
Oh, okay.
Bruce watches.
Damian Wayne is like his actual son, though.
Oh, I didn't know he had. Who did he have a kid with?
Robin.
Ra's al Ghul's daughter.
Who the fuck
stole Batman's palm and put it inside her daughter?
I don't know shit about.
Ra's al Ghul is like the dude who uses the Lazarus Pit to like give himself eternal life, essentially. Like every like.
I don't know shit about DC.
Whatever, he'll take a dip into this thing called the Lazarus Pit and like kind of like makes him youthful again. It's the thing that brought Jason Todd back to life.
Who? I don't know. I don't read these fucking comics, dude.
Bro, just play DC Universe. I got all that shit from
But anyways.
Don't play it, though, because it sucks.
What? Mortal Kombat versus DC Universe?
No, DC. No, the MMO. Game.
What? Oh.
It's a free, like,
MMO. Oh, 1 second. Can you turn that off?
Yes.
I'm going to call it up
now. The only reason I know as much as I do about DC is because of that game.
Really?
Yeah, because you like...
Hello, everyone. My name's Jackson, and I don't know how to turn the camera off, so...
Okay, wait, the camera's not off?
I don't know how to turn...
Wait, okay, keep recording me. I'm on the phone call. Okay, wait, are you on the line? Fuck, it was a scam call.
Oh.
Anyways, so...
What a guy.
Batman has, like, I feel like...
Wait, the scam caller hung up on you? Insane.
They do that now. So I feel like Batman has some of the best aspects of Stoicism because, you know, he is a good and calm person who stops corruption and has some basic morals, right? But he also is the worst aspects of it. Batman is an emotionally fucked up dude because of what he's done to himself.
Mm.
And I think there's also a very long tradition of Stoicism and sexism being close to each other. Mostly because Stoicism was made in Athens, which was a really sexist society.
Yeah.
You know how, like, there is kind of a common complaint I've seen on internet female spaces making fun of guys of, like, the, you know, the calm, logical male, you know, who, oh, why are you crying, honey? Let me logically fix your problems.
And men will do everything except go to therapy type beat.
Yeah, and I think some of that literally does come from how the male brain is different from the female brain. I think there's a biological component to how problems are addressed. But I think men are also taught to have a very stoic philosophy to life. And I think one of our masculine idols we're told to look up to as kids is Batman. And Batman does that.
I thought Batman was kind of lame, though, so I'm free.
You looked up the Sonic and turned out okay.
Yeah, bro, yeah.
Yeah, baby.
And I don't know, so the fact that Batman's... I feel like this sexist, stoic, nasty aspect of Batman really manifests in this story. Like, Batman doesn't look good in this Killing Joke story, right? Like, he shouldn't have fucked that girl. He probably shouldn't have risked everyone's life, abandoned Gordon to have a relationship conversation with Joker. He looks kind of pathetic. And I think this is an aspect of Batman that is there, and it's good for us to look at. And I think the reason so many people viscerally hate this movie is they don't want to see the ugly sludge around their, like, god hero.
The ugly sludge.
The ugly truth.
You know, like...
Like, it's like we're saying, like, never
be mystified.
Yeah. Like, because then you'll see the bad side of him, you know?
It's like the smaller version of when you point out the ugly sludge around Jesus Christ. You know, like, when you point out how God is abusive as fuck in the Old Testament.
You know how Jesus had a brother? Crazy.
Jesus had a brother?
He did.
What was his name? Jesus?
I don't know.
Not me thinking the same goddamn thing. Fuck you. Fuck you.
But you know what I mean? Like, I feel like any time you have a hero or a god, you have to be careful because there's always a reality behind it, and the reality is always tainted, right?
Yeah.
And you always have to, like, you have to touch the dark part of it before it's safe to swim around. And I think this is a really easy way to do that with Batman.
Mm-hmm. Murder the Joker.
The what?
I feel like, sorry to keep rambling, but I'm getting closer and closer. I feel like a lot of Batman edgy content is edgy for the sake of being edgy.
Yes, sir.
And this Batman content is as edgy as it fucking gets, but it also really touches something true and dark and wrong about the character in it. And I don't think it does it intentionally.
His penis.
His bat cock.
His bat cock.
Damn,
roll credits.
Came out, like, I think it was relatively recently where, like, the artist drew, like, Batman was naked in the scene, and the artist, he was, like, silhouetted, but the artist included the silhouette of his dick
Yeah!
It was like a huge backlash.
And I was like, we don't want to see Batman's dick. We want to, like, what? All right, bro.
Do y'all remember the, like, thing where, Batman was eating cat girl out, and it was like, heroes don't eat women out?
Yeah.
What?
Alright, that's my lecture, but since we're all chilling anyways, I'm down to keep the camera on and talk about the new Batman movie.
I haven't seen it.
Oh, dude.
Have you seen it?
Yeah, I have. I saw it when
they
came out.
Yeah, I went with them. It was a good movie. I'm not really a good judge of whether or not those movies are bad or good, but I thought it was good.
Do you mind spoilers?
Not, I don't care.
I thought the movie was alright.
Really? Yeah, I thought it was worthwhile cinema.
I like their interpretation of that. It felt different. He felt like an angry kid.
That's when he was like starting out as Batman.
What's the name of the chick that played Batwoman? Catwoman. What is her name?
She was hot, but her character was so poor. Like, that romance had no spark behind it.
Yeah, you're right. But I would absolutely tear her shit in two. Like, god damn.
At the end of the movie, when they're driving away from each other, and you said something like, we were born to mate.
No. I was talking about that. There's a fucking, like, a side mission in GTA 5 where Trevor tries to, like have sex with this like running chick, and he chases after her on a fucking bicycle, and it's just like, we were born to procreate. It's just really wild. And then they don't, and it was disappointing.
So you seem to have some passing knowledge of Batman. What is your favorite Batman movie?
I like out of like the live action movies, or just my favorite animated like just DC movie in general is Batman Under the Red Hood.
Yes.
Just because I really like the Red Hood. Like, he's my favorite like comic character.
I managed to watch that one completely unspoiled.
Yeah, so did I, because I watched that like when it came out as a kid.
Oh, cool.
Yeah, dude, I love that movie so much.
Isn't it crazy? That's fucking Bender who plays the Joker in that.
Hate. Dear Lord Vader, please punish me for my sins. The last Vadercock vision I received intrigued me, turned me on a little.
The thought of young Natalie Portman's frail body, surrounded, held by Anakin's will,
reminded me of Batcock.
Made me wet.
I wanted more.
Not enough, I'm not enough.
So I did what I had to. I prayed to Darth Vader, the Sith Lord, 5 times a day, for weeks, and then, May 4th, it came to me.
A vision of Vader crashing through my wall. He looked at me, judged me, said I was weak, commanded me to give him the child. I looked behind me, saw my inner child. He wouldn't really kill him, would he? Then I remembered, Lord Vader was literally a school shooter.
He pulled out his lightsaber, I pulled out mine, Lord Vader tortured me. Amen.
Really?
I actually know the
dude from How I Met Your Mother plays Nightwing.
Wait, which dude?
What's your favorite Batman movie?
Yeah.
I don't think I've seen any.
Yeah, he plays Nightwing. And then Jensen Ackles from Dean from Supernatural plays the Red Hood.
Oh, no, I like the Bane one.
Yeah, Jensen Ackles.
Oh, the Bane one.
I think Bane is cool.
You know Dean from Supernatural also plays Batman in a new Batman movie?
Really?
Yeah, I think Long Halloween.
He's also Soldier Boy in The Boys.
He is?
Yeah.
I just got introduced to Soldier Boy last night.
Yeah.
That's crazy.
To fucking who?
Soldier Boy.
Yes.
Yeah,
not Soldier Boy. Soldier Boy. Like, the boys' version of Captain America.
What the fuck? You may as well just have military man.
Yeah, I just got introduced. I'm on season 3 of The Boys right now. I don't know if you guys watch that.
I'm going to. I have Amazon Prime.
Watch it.
Start the first episode, like, make a big meal, and then just start watching the first episode while you're eating.
Wait, why?
Yeah.
This is something you gotta, like, sit down and, like,
share. Like, I did. I ordered, like, a sub from the sub place down the street of my house. I booted up season 3, episode 1 of The Boys. I'm eating food, and I'm like, yeah.
Okay.
Hey guys, welcome back for another mukbang. Today we're watching The Boys.
Okay, this honestly might just be a film kid thing, but I had the same problem with the new Sandman show. It just looks so bland, like so TV, like 14,
yeah,
colorless. Like, do you know what I mean? When it's like that TV visual drabness where like the story's cool but there's just fucking nothing to look at, and I can't do that for,
because it's like TV quality. Is that like movie quality, or
it's not even the quality though, because some
it's TV just shows, everything looks too clean.
The way it's composed is soulless.
Yeah, like I like colorful TV, or when there's a pop of something, you know. Yeah. Or I don't mind if shows look like that for maybe like 20 minutes or for like a 15 minute YouTube video, but I can't look at nothing, it feels like to me, for 40 to an hour.
How did you get through Community?
I started watching Community because I know Keith David shows up in it.
Just get to season 6.
But then I was like, I wanted to see these characters grow and develop, but then I was like, damn, I don't like these characters. So I just dropped it, like, around season 3 or midway season 2.
Well, as I've grown up and my brain's developed, I just can't watch Community anymore.
Yeah.
It hurts.
I don't, yeah. But, your Batman lecture over?
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
You came in right after it ended.
Oh, okay, cool. Sweet. Damn.
Well, I talked about how I think Batman, like, the person, like, the character Batman is inherently sexist. Like, I think he's a sexist guy.
Batman watches Ben Shapiro, Andrew Tate, Keith, Kevin Samuels.
Honestly, I feel like Superman was also originally conservative because he grew up in fucking Smallville, right?
Yeah. Fucking some random-ass town in Kansas.
And then I think he moved to Metropolis.
And then
like,
he like got his mind opened up, I guess. Right?
His mind.
He's like, wait a second.
He broke out some toe-curling head.
Do I have time to do the lecture I was going to do?
Okay,
yeah, let's go set up my board.
Oh, wait, no, you can keep going as you set up the board. We can keep fucking talking about Superman.
Yeah, do it.
Yeah.
Have you ever watched Gotham by Gaslight?
That's on my list. Okay.
That one was really good, too.
Honestly, one night I watched the Batcock movie, and I was blown away because, like, I had such a... I hadn't had this profound of an experience with Batman since Red Hood.
Yes.
The Batcock.
Yeah.
So I was like, fuck, Batman's fun again. So I just watched every Batman movie I could on HBO Max, and none of them lived up.
Really?
You know what would have been the best fucking prompt for this is your giant black dildo that your brother gave you for Christmas, because it's like
Oh, the Batcock?
Yeah! Yeah!
Wait.
You knew where it was,
immediately.
Like, fucking pinpointed that shit.
Wait, move it over to the left a little bit.
Oh, you're stuck.
Wait, put it on the whiteboard.
What the fuck?
Hold on, I gotta get a portrait shot of this.
I know, I gotta get like this.
No!
Wait, I gotta get like
this.
No, wait.
Horrible.
No, I already got the composition in mind. Wait, it's like.
Right. You are all just absolutely like no fear handling this fucking show.
I mean, I assumed it was.
Wait, can someone throw it at me real quick?
Yeah.
Tyler's 14-year-old brother got it for him for Christmas.
What the fuck? What the fuck? We're gonna get canceled.
Damn, it's got like texture too.
Can you throw that at me real quick?
Wait.
Can this be the thumbnail?
Like, we don't care about monetization, so it's
What the fuck? Wait, why is it so heavy? How? Like, it really hurt my leg.
Roland is gonna watch this and be so happy he didn't come, because imagine trying. Nobody tell Roland that we have a giant black
dildo
so he gets scared with it.
This is not what balls feel like. Is this what you
beat? No, this is what black balls feel like.
I wouldn't know, so maybe you're right. Maybe you're right.
Tyler.
Wait, I wanna, like, suction cup into
it. I'm gonna stop recording now.
Schizoanalysis. So, basically, a lot of conceptual models of the world. Think like Christianity, right, is a model of the world, or even Marxism is a model of understanding the world. Or a better example would be like materialist atheism. The world started with a big bang, and all things evolved out of that. if that makes sense. Like a meta-narrative.
Okay.
So, meta-narratives often take the structure of a world tree, where there's one central concept, such as a Christian god, or a, like, a Buddhist truth, the need to awaken to some divine enlightenment, and all things branch off this central truth. Does that make sense? And what schizoanalysis says is that the way to approach stuff is to actually think of them as, like, entangled roots. So there is no central. All meta structures are interlinked with each other. There is no truth. There is only billions of truths that are supported and contrasted in this weird pulsing network with each other. And we have to understand things by analyzing multiple different versions of reality that contrast each other to understand the full universe perspective, so all things can kind of flow into each other. And that's why Deleuze is so fucking impossible to read. Does schizoanalysis make basic sense?
What I'm trying to say is that this lecture has been a schizoanalysis of the Killing Joke. Schizoanalysis is really effective as an arts analysis tool for things like remakes. You know, if you're trying to integrate, for example, the Killing Joke movie into the comic, or if you're trying to integrate the new Star Wars Darth Vader TV show back into the George Lucas Star Wars vomit, you know, or if you're trying to integrate a series of addendums into a Batman lecture, schizoanalysis is the key. Darth Vader wears his suit because of his traumatic incident with Obi-Wan in Episode 3 of Revenge of the Sith. In some sense, being enclosed in his suit, he is enclosed in his trauma. This is something my therapist told me, one of the reasons I should not be obsessing over Darth Vader. And Batman, similarly, is enclosed in a suit that is representative of his childhood trauma. See, Darth Vader, when he was a child, Anakin Skywalker, he was a slave. He and his mom were owned by a cruel businessman, Watto, and Anakin many nights witnessed Watto beat his mom, and he sat there with C-3PO, the AI he created to comfort him, helpless, powerless to do anything. And finally, the Jedi gave him an opportunity to escape this horribly abusive environment, and he took it, but at the cost of abandoning his mom. The rules of the Jedi is to abandon, you know, all your fucking emotions, and so for years he sat with the Jedi, wondering what was happening to his mom, and finally, when he got the fucking balls to break the Jedi code and give into his fucking humanity, the dark side of the Force, and go there and check on her, and it was too late, and she was fucking dead. He was weak. And this anger and this hatred. There's this horribly sad moment in the Obi-Wan TV show where Obi-Wan and Darth Vader run into each other, and Obi-Wan, like, cracks Darth Vader's mask and, like, sees into Anakin's eyes, and he's like, "Anakin, it's you!" And Anakin is like, "You know, I am Darth Vader. I killed Anakin." You know, I cried when I watched it, and I think part of the reason it's so sad is because Darth Vader feels so fucking alone. And he's just trying to reach out, and Obi-Wan, the love he so desperately needs, is right there. Obi-Wan is reaching out, and Darth Vader refuses. And doesn't that kind of remind you how the Joker refused Batman's offer for love, support, and forgiveness in The Killing Joke? Ooh, connection. And some of this, I think, is because Obi-Wan says Anakin, and when Darth Vader hears that name Anakin, he doesn't feel like he's being seen. He feels like they have this idea of what Anakin is in their head, and that he's not that. And so they're asking for him to pretend to be something he's not. They're rejecting the evil that he is.
you know, part of growing and healing and getting over the rage, but he has become the rage. And so to love the healed him and to reject the sinner is just to reject what he is. It's angering. And so the difference between Darth Vader and Batman is at the end of Batman Beyond movie, when the Robins he had been emotionally detached from the entire TV series finally reach out to him, that love is available, and he grabs onto it. He's not angry and bitter like Darth Vader, and Bruce accepts that love and is able to grow and die happy while Darth Vader suffers and is bitter and alone. I imagine some of you have been told that Darth Vader did not die bitter and alone, that he was redeemed, saved by his son Luke Skywalker. This is a lie. Rebel GOP propaganda. I will now tell you the truth.
The days are cold. The only thing that's preventing me from every suffering is my favorite treat of them all, which is ice cream. People say this life is a shithole. Others say that it's beautiful. I say we all belong 6 feet in the dirt. The pile of trash piles high as I feel like I want to die. I love my homies, and I just don't know why. Life may be tough, but you know, who gives a fuck? Stay positive. I love you.
Ars Mal N Week 13. So, he's an interesting content creator. He makes, like, vlog videos on Pornhub, and most of it's just, like, him chilling, smoking marijuana, walking around his tiny apartment, talking about how he's happy he moved out of his parents, and he talks about, like, the glories of Satanism. And then there's occasional on-screen masturbation, and it's bizarre and interesting and worth checking out if that at all sounds appealing to you. I thought I'd point that out. Okay, now we are going to be talking about Cheeve and his cock, and I swear this relates to Darth Vader and the whole him not being redeemed thing. It doesn't relate to the porn vlogger, though. That guy's name is Austin. Unrelated. Alright, we're talking about Cheeve and his cock. Does everybody get that? Same page? So Cheeve was born into a noble family. You know, he was rich from birth, always had his needs catered to, servants obeying his every whim, but his father was kind of a sociopath. The only reason he had children and a wife to begin with was it was, you know, fitting for a politician to have a family on Naboo and all that shit. But, as far as, like, father and emotional availability, all that stuff, he was completely absent from Sheev's life. And so Cheeve was really desperate for, you know, any sort of parental or fatherly attention. And so he was extremely gifted at everything he did. He excelled in every sort of academic, practical, programming course. And so he hoped that his, you know, high performance when he was 6'7" would get him attention, but it didn't. And so while he continued to perform highly in everything without trying, he also began to act out in very loud ways. This kind of climaxed when he was 16 and got in like a land speeder bike and ran over a family on the streets just to, you know, feel something. And he knew he was gonna get off because his father couldn't have the scandal, so he paid everyone, kept it quiet, and he felt no guilt. He just was kind of sad that it only jolted him a little bit. And then Lord Plagueis enters the story. Sith Lord Plagueis landed on the planet Naboo. Now, Lord Plagueis is like an old, I'm not gonna say friend, more like an advisor of Sheev's father. So, this is a weird point in Sith history. This is after the rule of two has been established by Sith Lord Bane, who at this point is like ancient history. The basic idea is, long ago, there used to be, like, an entire empire of Sith warriors. And And Bane kind of realized that to truly follow the Sith religion properly, this is a religion about getting what you want, grabbing power, being merciless. And this could not be followed in such a large, organized society. And he was like, this is not what Sith are. You are inherently compromising and bastardizing your beliefs. And so what we need to do is only have two Sith, a master and an apprentice to train on. So the Sith is always continued. And anyone who tries to be a Sith apart from the two, the Sith should seek out and kill. And this way he was trying to produce the most powerful Sith. So there'd only be a few, and they'd be true warriors, Sith. So this lineage had been passed down to Plagueis, but as much as Plagueis was interested in power, he was more interested in immortality. See, part of the idea is the Sith would want their apprentice to kill them, because by the time the apprentice was strong enough to kill you, you deserve to die, because you wanted power to continue, not necessarily yourself. But Lord Plagueis was obsessed with ego himself. He wanted immortality. He wanted to find a way for him to continue for all time. And so he was very interested in, like, researching the Force and all of this stuff. He was more of an academic than a true Sith Lord, albeit a very powerful academic. And so one of his academic quirks is that he was interested in dark people and dark things around the galaxy, and would occasionally go and check up on them. And one of the pools of darkness he sensed in the Force was Sheev's kind of sociopathic political father, who was exerting his political reign upon Naboo. I promise, we will get to Sheev's cock. It's coming. Get it? Coming. When Plagueis came back to Naboo, he noticed Sheev's energy immediately. He was on the inside of Sheev. He didn't sense any personhood or ego. There was complete nothingness, just swarming rage and desire with some sort of vague center. There was really no self, just a desire for power and more for the sake of power and more itself. On the inside, there was nothing. There was infinite blackness inside of Sheev. He had no Force potential that he could sense, but he could sense the epitome of the dark side itself. So, this interested Mr. Academic Plagueis. So, Plagueis kind of starts questioning Sheev, and he goes, you know, what do you want? What do you want? Plagueis goes, you say you have no ambition to get a political office like your father. Is that true? And Sheev says, not quite. And Plagueis smiles, to what political position do you aspire? Do you want to be, you know, noble of Naboo? King of Naboo? King of the solar system? Chancellor of the Grand Republic? And Sheev says no to all of that. He says, I don't want any of those, you know, positions. That means nothing. What I want is to rule. And Plagueis says, you know, what do you want to rule? And Sheev says, you know, you think I was stupid if I told you. And Plagueis said, if you're to become my apprentice, a Sith, you cannot be ashamed of your desire. And Sheev kind of lighted up and said, I want to rule everything. Where the fuck is the unrecord button? This answer pleased Sith Lord Plagueis greatly. So, Sith Lord Plagueis kind of starts stoking the already existing conflict between Sheev and his father. You know, kind of proking and prodding, starting little arguments here and there. Alright, goodbye to the set. We are going well beyond. Ooh! I'm gonna give a lecture about these poems later.
Cyberpunk haiku, by the book, be head of the curve.
So this leads to a big fight between Chief and his father, where his father's like, you know, you're a spineless bitch and you've always been a fucking inconvenience to me. And Chief is like, I don't know about spineless. And then Chief proceeds to kill his father and his entire family, his mother, his siblings, everyone who just sat there and watched him get abused and ignored by his worthless sack of shit father, who couldn't even make a strong political decision, was too stupid to realize allying himself with the Galactic Republic was the path to fucking power. He was so scared of being a smaller fish in a bigger pond. He didn't want to lose his little Naboo game and compete in galactic politics. He was cowardly, he was weak, and needed to die, and so did everyone that thought and he was good and leaned on him for support. The woman who thought he was worthy of marrying all deserved to fucking die. And so, you know, he stabbed them with a knife and whatnot. Bro, nature is beautiful this time of year. I mean, like, you know, it's always pretty, but especially that lush early spring green. So anyways, turns out killing your family is like a fairly classic Sith training requirement. It's one Darth Vader got away with not doing because, you know, he didn't actually have a family. So by killing his family, Sheev passed the rites of the Sith, the final test, without ever actually formally doing it. And this is how he unlocked the dark side powers he always had. And it's interesting, it's highly implied that Sheev, being a sociopath himself, from a very early age had to learn how to mask emotions. You know, kind of reminds me when I was really little, when I was 4, I had this obsession with nuclear bombs, right? And I would love telling my mom about how funny beef a nuclear bomb dropped in my city. And she was a young protester. She was actually protesting the nuclear waste being placed outside her town when she was a kid. So she was pretty anti-nuclear stuff. And she was like, Tyler, do you know what you're talking about? Do you understand that nuclear bombs will, like, rip the flesh off children and kill millions of people, and the people who survive, you know, have horrible mutations, will be passed on horrible pain for generations? And I was like, yeah, I couldn't explain to my mom that that's exactly why nuclear bombs were cool, you know? So I pretended to be all sad and went like, oh, I'm sorry. And like learning to mask emotions like that at 4, it, more extremely in Sheev's case, gave him the ability to naturally kind of mask and cover his Force ability, which is Sheev's, like, super Sith power, you might say. He can completely cloak his presence. He can hide his Force ability, so Jedi and Sith can't sense him even when he's in plain sight. This seems like a good time to explain something about how Darth Vader's Force works. So normally, Force users, or Jedi, light side Force users specifically, are following, like, the flow of Force. See, one way to think of Force is like a series of invisible strings in the air connecting everything that you can pull on, tug on, follow, fall with, right? And there's like paths, like wind flowing, blowing through these Force strings. And so, you know, especially in the Clone Wars, when you're watching Jedi do all these crazy flips and twirls and jumping off strings, what they're doing is they're following the current of Force flow. They're moving along with it. And what's the big difference between Sith and Jedi Forces is that the Jedi follow the Force flow to get to their path, and the Sith bend the Force flow to do what they want. They grab it, they abuse it, they hurt it, right? Just like how the way you make a Sith lightsaber is, the red ones, is that you take a lightsaber crystal and you pour all your rage and hatred into it, making the crystal experience everything you have, and then you hurt it and the crystal bleeds, making that red color. And it took a while for Darth Vader to get to that point of his Sith training. And so for a while, he had to abandon his Jedi lightsaber and just fight using the Force, which is why Vader is very Force-reliant in his combat style. You'll notice Anakin jumps around a lot and is, you know, very athletic, while Vader is very stilted, frozen. His movements are simple.
And you might think this is because, you know, Vader has a robot body, but actually, you see in the comics, the cybernetic enhanced body is actually kind of more able than Anakin's meat body. It can do all the crazy flips and jumps. Vader is fucking scary. He just doesn't, because why, when you can just will what you want with the Force, grab it, move it, make it happen, you know? So remember how Darth Plagueis was obsessed with immortality? So he did a lot of, like, studying how using the Force to affect metachlorians could create and prolong life. And he hadn't quite gotten to prolonging life indefinitely yet, but he had figured out how to create life. And so Sheev, early on, studied this from him and decided that he was gonna try to create the perfect slave. Someone, you know, all-powerful, that would be all-obedient for him. And he had him born on a faraway planet to come to him. He twisted his strings and destined him to come upon him and obey him. And of course, that slave was Anakin, who would grow to be Darth Vader. Sheev made sure Vader was born a slave, twisted his fate strings, Force strings, made sure that his childhood was filled with pain, suffering, hate. Vader, Sheev is your father. There's this episode of Batman Beyond that released a few years after the show ended. It's not even really an episode of Batman Beyond, it's more of a Justice League special tie-in to Batman Beyond. Anyways, in this episode, they have this very weird twist that reveals that Terry is actually Batman's biological son, unbeknownst to both of them, because Amanda Waller was afraid that there was going to be no Batman after Bruce died, and so she took some of his DNA and impregnated it into a, like, suitable woman so there could be a Batman 2, and then she hired an assassin to kill his dad so he had the same trauma as Bruce, so those genes would also cause him to become Batman. And in this episode, they also reveal that the government was aware of Bruce Wayne's potential power when he was a kid, and so they had a government assassin ready to kill his parents to give him the push he needed to become something great superhero-wise, to stop an alien threat they knew was gonna happen in the future or some shit. And the assassin realized he couldn't do it, but then it was okay, because the same night a mugger killed him anyways. Stupid, stupid shit. But I find this interesting, and I think it really thematically connects to this idea of Sheev giving birth to Vader through the Force, you know, Sheev being Vader's father. And it's that, this idea that your life is being organized for you to turn you into something horrible, you know, like, someone has a plan for you, but it's not God, it's not him making everything alright, it's fucking Satan. I think Juice WRLD said it best, you know, why did it always feel like the devil's plotting? I'm gonna get ticks, but the shot's so cool, look at this beautiful greenery! Anyways, I've been reading the Quran recently, and they talk a lot about Satan, like, how do I explain this? Alright, so the idea is, like, life itself, in a sense, is God. Every obstacle moment presented to you is something crafted by God, and it's an opportunity to reveal who you are. You know, characters reveal themselves through action, response to conflict. You get to be who you are in response to every single moment. Every single pain and pleasure you experience is either crafted by God to test you or bring you closer to him, or it's crafted by Satan. Usually it's the way the Quran explained, it's like a co-crafting of God and Satan, which is kind of, I feel like, an allusion to the idea that God and Satan are truly one and the same. Anyways, yeah, that's what the whole Sheev giving birth to Darth Vader made me think of. So anyways, after Sheev unlocks his dark side power, he starts... Well, first, he takes, like, 5 years off to train in dark side abilities, because he knew it'd be difficult to do that and pursue super public office at the same time. But eventually, after he feels like he has sufficient mastery from Plagueis, he runs for office, he takes control of his dad's old position, he joins the Galactic Republic, and then he becomes a senator in the Republic.
Then he organizes a massive attack to happen on his planet, making major controversy in his planet, make him like newsworthy in the center of attention, and he uses that to launch a platform for basically presidency, becomes a chancellor, and then creates a fake clone war, and then uses that to launch himself to emperor, slowly gaining more and more power for the executive branch in response to these threats, saying, I need slightly more power, you know, it's a parody of Bush. But right after he was elected chancellor, Plagueis came to Sheev to, you know, visit and celebrate, especially because around the same time that Sheev was elected chancellor, Plagueis achieved a great victory of his own. He finally figured out immortality, and so he taught this to his student so they could be the rule of two, the two Siths forevermore. And then for the first time in 25 years, Lord Plagueis fell asleep, Sheev kills Plagueis in his sleep, and then now he's the all-powerful Sith. You know, that's the story. Something I find interesting is that as far as we know, Plagueis never cloned himself, and he had knowledge of Kamino, so this is something that was available to him. And the reason I think he didn't do this is because he saw the clone as not himself, and he wanted himself to continue. He was preserved about his ego. Meanwhile, Palpatine, as we find out from the sequel trilogy, is more than happy to keep himself alive via cloning. And I think the difference here, it's really illuminating. It shows you the difference between Palpatine and Plagueis. Palpatine worships Palpatine, the beauty of himself, the idea of himself. So as long as Palpatine continues, it's fine. It's not about me. Meanwhile, Darth Plagueis is only concerned about the literal him that is experiencing reality, not the him that has been crafted. But Sidious Sheev can't conceive of him, the reality, perceiving everything around him, because as you recall, he is nothingness, he is a black void, he is nothing but these masks crafted around himself to fulfill desire, and that series of masks is what he wants to preserve. Sheev had become convinced that he was an all-powerful Sith Lord. All of these successes, being Chancellor of the Galaxy, was not particularly good for his out-of-control ego. But he was a grand Sith Lord who had not actually been in all that many fights. So when he got into a duel with Yoda and almost got his ass kicked, this was a, you know, terrifying moment. It's kind of like when Emperor Qin was almost assassinated and became obsessed with immortality. From here, he decided he would spend his time as Emperor mostly refining his abilities and pursuing the dark arts of the Force and becoming physically the most powerful being in the world so no one could conquer him. Now, this kind of leaves the obvious question. If he's busy doing all of this stuff, how is he, you know, running the Empire? So he delegates a lot, right? But how does he keep his delegates loyal? Well, part of Sheev's ability, so he can cloak his presence, right? He can hide his mind, and he can go inside other people's. He's good at sensing other people's paths, twisting their fates, their strengths. So as you rise into the Empire, you get into this hell where all of a sudden the Emperor is in your mind all of the time, making sure you are obedient, loyal, checking in, good slave, and when you're not, you are tortured from afar via the Force. And that's how he keeps his lieutenants in line, obedient slaves, meat puppets essentially, while he gets stronger and stronger, and they allow him to manifest his iron will upon the entire galaxy. This ability of his to see into others made his time with the Jedi especially fun when he was, you know, just Chancellor, because he could see into their minds, see them looking for the Sith Lord and know they would never find them, hiding in plain sight. And he also was so
amused and equally frustrated by the arrogance of Jedi, you know. They were constantly looking inside, perfecting their imperfections, removing evilness from themselves, that they weren't busy sensing the obvious around them. They were so arrogant, that's why Sidious keeps calling the Jedi arrogant throughout the prequel trilogy. And because Sidious doesn't really understand the concept of self-reflection, because he doesn't have that much of a self to reflect on. Remember, what Palpatine, what Sheev is emptiness. So, the psychology of the Jedi was very frustrating and alien to him, and this was especially true for Yoda. So remember, Sheev can sense other people's force better than pretty much anyone else, right? So it was extremely obvious to Sheev that Yoda was more powerful than any other of the Jedi. He was, like, reeking of eldritch power. And it frustrated him that the Jedi never fucking acknowledged this. This wasn't even part of their fucking politics. They had this nuclear bomb in the room and they didn't fucking care, you know? And then Yoda never acknowledged it. He was just humble. He walked around as if he was being piloted by the will of the Force. And this was so frustrating. He just wanted Yoda to stop fucking masking and unleash the thing he was. And it's funny, because I feel like some of this anger that Sheev is projecting is really anger towards himself again, because Yoda's not the one masking. He's content. He knows he's powerful. That's just a reserve tool. Sheev is the one constantly having a mask and pretending and hiding his power. He's kind of projecting this onto Yoda. And by the way, I'm getting all of this by analyzing the novelization of Attack of the Clones or Revenge of the Sith. They're pretty good. If you're a Star Wars nerd, you know, they go into the psychology of everybody, because, you know, the prequels aren't really... The prequels have, like, the raw aesthetic and mythology of something amazing, but they don't have the psychological depth, and so the novels really kind of spin and add it. They're nice. And it's this beautiful irony, of course, that Palpatine wants Yoda to, you know, unsheath his power. And when Yoda finally does, it's way too fucking much for him, and he's gotta fucking run. It makes that showdown pathetic, and why it's so ultimately scarring, why it further fuels Palpatine's obsession for physical force power. Power. Thrusting. Masculine. Power. Another fucked up thing about the way Sheev views the world, you know, as most powerful force users do, they see the world not as objects, but as energy, waves of energy, everything manifestations, and he sees everything, or the average thing is slave, feminine, you know, something to be implanted in, something to be morphed by will, masculine force, and so most things that are feminine are nothing to Sheev, are to be shoved away. It only worth addressing other quote-unquote, you know, masculine power generating forces, and unless they're of a significant size, the way you treat them is by crushing them and pushing them back down into the void of nothingness of femininity. It's bizarre, it's hateful, it's very Sheev. You know, you can see how Vader's father kind of fucked him up. So after Sheev and Yoda duel, Yoda ends up running. And so, you know, Sheev sent Vader, Mr. Jedi Hunting Squad, after him, right? What do you think happened when Vader went to go kill Yoda? He landed on Dagobah. You know, his entire life, Sheev never had a friend. He didn't really have a self to share. He just had masks to put on to placate the people he ran into. In his entire life, that's all he was, a collection of masks around a swirling hole of nothingness. And now, for the moment you have all been waiting for, Sheev's cock. So, I recently had a vision of Emperor Palpatine's cock. And as far as I'm concerned, it's canon to Star Wars, and I think you should approach it that way too. Remember how, like, the job of a Batman mage is to uncover something true about the essence of Batman? Well, as a Sheev mage, I've uncovered something true about Sheev, his cock.
which, by the way, his cock is smaller. That's Batman's cock. If you want to picture Sheeves, think, like, about 2/3 as long and, like, half as thick.
Fuck! Shit!
Here's kind of the gist. Batman characters kind of grow like religions. You know how, like, the Bible, you know, like, religions aren't written. No religion that some guy sits down and writes has any fucking merit. Religions have to grow over hundreds of years. The natural result of the society pouring into it, their values weirdly crystallizing. In the same sense, the true canon of Batman nobody writes. It's contributed by billions of people. There are hundreds and hundreds of Batman stories being written, and only some of them are good enough to latch on, to grab on for all of us to go, yes, that is Batman, to become part of our conscience. Does that make sense? And the way this Batman plant is growing is also interesting, because it's a reflection of our society and societal pressures molding this, you know, thing.
So, per my vision, Sheev didn't really have any game or luck with the ladies, and so he was a virgin well into his 30s. There was some incest in his childhood, but I'm not really counting that. So, the first sexual encounter he had was when he was starting his political career and was finally rising high enough to kind of start receiving some of the benefits with came with being, you know, high political office in Naboo. And this came with many opportunities for sex. And so finally he took one and he had a wonderful night. He came, and then afterwards the lady looked into his eyes and, you know, she saw him. She saw him as a organic creature, a piece of meat, a part of nature that came at him, was repeating the cycle, a collection of muscles that tensed and untensed just like her.
Palpatine sensed this, felt her heart, saw himself as immortal through her eyes.
But Sheev was not just like her, he was a fucking god. To fucking see him as this mess of goo is part of the fucking force and not as this glorious individual that she should worship, be on her knees sucking the dick of. It enraged him, and so he killed her. And that's when he knew that he was never going to take a wife. And in fact, this lack of sexual desire that was in his life after this really benefited him when he was on Coruscant, because one of the major claims he had while he was rising to political power and eventually senator or chancellor of the Galactic Republic was that the Galactic Senate was corrupt, and this was of course backed by the fact that he wasn't. The paparazzi, the press, would never catch him, you know, sleeping with some secretary or doing death sticks, because he didn't sleep with secretaries and he didn't do death sticks. He had no need for those things. His desire for power and the dark side of the Force was more than enough to sustain Sheev. So, Yoda didn't choose to hide on Dagobah for the scenery, as much of a swamp creature he kind of appears to be. He chose Dagobah because it had that cave, right? It was a giant Force nexus, in the same way that the temple where Coruscant is was built on a natural Force nexus on a mountain. So, this Force nexus on Dagobah was dark side tainted, and Yoda went there because the dark side tainting of that would cloak his light side Force signature. Now, the reason there's a cave on this planet has to do with something it's largely believed he did when he was a younger Jedi who went by the name of Midge. And he was involved in some sort of battle, and the result of this battle was giving birth to this dark side Force nexus in the cave. And Midge, later Yoda, told his apprentice Count Dooku about this. Now, Count Dooku left the Jedi Order, and before he did, he deleted a number of worlds from the Jedi systems.
This included Dagobah. Now, we don't know why he did this. He was hiding all sorts of Dark Side worlds that we believe that Sidious and Dooku were investigating and looking for relics in at the time. But it's also possible he deleted Dagobah because he planned on hiding there in the same sense later on, as he knew about that Force Nexus. So, Yoda noticed that this planet was missing, and he knew there was a Force Nexus there. The only way to get to it is with a droid who has previous memory of going there, which is why R2 was able to guide Luke to it even though it wasn't in any nav systems. So this was a pretty good hiding spot. But Count Dooku, Darth Tyrannus, was the apprentice of Lord Sidious, so Lord Sidious also happened to know about this cave, and investigated with a probe, found Yoda, unbeknownst to Yoda, and sent Vader to kill him. A true Sith would go themselves, finish the battle they never could, but Sheev was a student of Plagueis, neither of which were true Sith. They were bastardizations of the religion, based on ego preservation, no worship for power. And so, like the little bitch he was, Sheev sent his apprentice, Lord Vader.
Hey, Liam, Shannon.
Yeah, what's up?
Have you heard the story of Lord Vietate? I think I said his name wrong.
Vietate?
The no, Veggie. Tyler, I haven't heard of Lord
Vietate. Have you heard the good word of Andrew Tate?
Not Andrew Tate. So he's a Lord of the Sith in Star Wars.
Oh, okay. I haven't heard of this one. Which one is he? Is he the one that, like, destroyed the entire planet?
Actually, yes.
Oh, he's that one!
Yes, I am currently filming.
Yeah.
What up? I know Star Wars.
Hi, YouTube!
Again with another Craig Guy video.
No,
you make sure to like this.
What have I done?
This is a Craig Guy video. If I manage to spin my headphones 3 times without failing, then you have to like this video.
So far, this lecture has been about, like, weaker Sith who aren't a good example of the legacy. So let me give you a quick example of, like, a true Sith. So, he was the son of a Sith Lord back in, like, the Sith Empire era when there were tons of them.
I'm not sure if that was, like, the Sith guy that when we're talking about destroying entire planets, the one that, like, fed off of the Force energy, he was a walking wound in the Force, that one?
Yeah.
He wasn't... We don't know really anything about him, actually.
More's been... Though, at least in Legends, Word Vivate has a backstory. Legends is no longer canon.
What I heard was that, like, he was on, like, a, like, we weren't even sure if he was originally a person or if he just was formed by the Force, but, or if he was just some random guy. Like
maybe we're talking about different characters who have similar attributes.
Because, like, let me see if I can find a photo of him, because, let's see,
But anyways, Lord Vi Veggie, whatever, he was a son of some Dark Lord, but, like, an illegitimate son, like a son with a servant.
This one, Darth Nihilus.
No, him. Not him.
Oh, you gotta see Darth Nihilus, that's the man.
Liam, stop derailing.
Derailing is the shock of you way.
You gotta look at Darth Nihilus, Tyler. You gotta, like...
Oh, I've seen a picture of him before, but I've never read
like
into his
lore. He was like a world eater, galaxy eater type thing.
Based. What have you seen, Shannon?
I have seen horrors unknown to man.
Me too. So is that guy. I was talking about the Sith Lord.
Yeah.
He is horrors unknown to man.
Well, see, the thing was, like, we don't really know much about him. There was some sort of war. I don't remember too much about it, because it's been a while since I remember hearing about him. But, like, something super happened. All of a sudden, all this dark energy, or dark force energy, just like, man, I don't remember much about it now that I think.
But like, so much evil happened that the dark force energy like coalesced and made
it
him.
Something happened and destroyed a planet, and like we're not even sure if he was a force user or even a person, but like he just came out of into existence. And so if you heard of a wound in the force, you ever heard of that?
No, I mean,
so like
in relation to Lord Vivate, but not this
guy.
Yeah,
so like wound in the force, like when the Death Star blew up the planet, it hurt like the Jedi, or like
oh, like Obi-Wan said he felt it when they destroyed Alderaan.
Yeah, or like when the Yoda was like, oh, oh, when like he felt all the Jedi dying in Order 66, like they can actually
they
feel
share
pain.
A hive mind?
No, but like
well, kind of through connecting to the same force energy.
They can't feel pain from each other, and so some are greater, some are less. He was a walking wound in the Force that was so great, like, Jedi couldn't really be near him. One Jedi had to cut their connection with the Force so that they didn't die.
Damn.
Yeah.
It's like how, like, Voldemort, like, can get near Harry and Harry just, like, fucking dies.
Yeah, he gets, like, the headache scar.
Yeah, and he gets migraines.
Like that. And essentially, at some point, like, if he, like, has this, he gets super powerful in the Force and, like, he starts, like, it's like eating people, but, like, with the Force.
You're, like, consuming them.
The essence. And at first, it starts off with, like,
that's how Darth Sidious killed his master, Lord Plagueis.
This sounds like a Greek myth.
Like, it starts off.
Star Wars is mythological.
It is, sounds very.
It starts off with, like, a few amount of people, then maybe it starts from, like, families, and then it goes to, like, villages, to, like, countries. And it starts to get to the point where he's incredibly powerful, but he's becoming so reliant on it like a drug. Like, he's going around eating entire worlds.
That's exactly what happens to Lord Vivate. He becomes dependent on it like a drug.
And then, like, it gets to the point where, like, in order to lure him into a trap where they kill him, like, they're, like, the Jedi say he's actually the weakest Sith because, sure, he was very powerful in the Force, but he was so reliant and also just so, like, blindsided by, like, the next thing. Like, he was easily lured by the promise of, like, a bunch of younglings in an entire world on this, like, a bunch of Jedi. It was, I mean, like, the Jedi Council type thing.
If you want to insist on the life energy, you have to, you would want to keep them alive. You want to raise them up, give you.
Well, he can't. It's, like, an exponential thing.
But also, if the two people who were able to do that then grew an addiction, what does that say about it as on itself? Like, what kind of drug is existence in this universe?
Well, the dark side has been considered, like, very, like, it's, like, very seductive to, like, the Jedi. That's the word that you can use. Like, it's, like, very
power
alluring.
Is seductive.
Yeah, it's not just power, though. Like, it is very much, like, a very heavy drug. And, like, at first, like, you might dissuade, like, how you use it. Like, oh, like, well, this was for this. Or, like, I mean, I have standards. I only do it because of this, or maybe. And eventually, like, they just get to the point where it's like, yeah, I know I'm evil. I don't care. I want to do this.
You know, that's kind of what luring is like. So, luring, you can, because everyone gets a defense, right? Even really fucked up people. And so it's really easy to start going, well, this is my case, and suddenly your career turns into defending a specialization of, like, fucked up people. But also the idea of what kind of drug life is, I feel like wanting to live forever, like the continuation of ego,
well,
that's the drug, you know?
Maybe that, but like even that, like animals, just anything in general, to like the smallest microorganisms, you can see them trying to fight to survive. There's something so terrifying to everything on this planet about death. They're willing to kill, like, tons of other things just to keep them alive, even if it's not forever.
I'm
and,
related,
like,
but do you want to see an art?
Yes.
Oh,
you
great.
You want to see
I
an
NFT? Just show it to the camera. Here's my art.
That's
the dark side.
Yeah,
is that
this
Rose?
Is the dark side. No, this is GoChild fan art. GoChild is a band.
GoChild sounds like a GoFundMe, but for, like, businesses that are starting up using child labor.
Go, child, go! Run, child!
Adam, I choose
cross
you! Make sandals! Make Nike!
So, Lord, I can't pronounce his name, but he's in the Old Republic games. I have played
oh,
them.
Oh, so was Nihilus. I wonder if it's like, it sounds like we're talking about the same person, like.
It's definitely not the same person.
Same eater of worlds.
Same archetype.
But,
archetype. It's interesting how Star Wars can feel so very, ancient.
Well, it's in a long time ago.
Tribal in its ways, but also densely futuristic. It's one of those things where,
like, the
theme is just that people are like this.
Did you know that George Lucas was a study of tribal music?
Oh, good for him.
I wonder if that kind of rubs off. This is the name I can't pronounce.
Yeah, though, but Darth Nihilus, it wasn't just that it was a drug, it's that he physically needed to eat like others, because, like, it would the dark side would start consuming him, and it would hurt, and it would, like, start killing him. So he just had to continue moving on to worlds, and, like,
like Galactus.
Like Galactus, except, like, he's not even, we're not even sure if he's conscious, if he's just more, he's not even, like,
It might just be a universe biological process.
It's yeah, it's almost like he's not even an animal. Like, it's almost like he's got the mind of, like, an amoeba. Wait, so like, it's just constant, like, needing to go forward.
Do you mean how, like, forest colonies will set themselves on fire semi-regularly to clean out and give themselves another start?
You know, that makes a lot of sense, actually.
Well, no, because he was in a...
You need the evil to wipe everything out, then take themselves with it, and then give a new start for a new era. Well, no, because
he was a permanent mark. Like, most... Like, every wound in the forest heals over time, except him and the place he came from. He just kept creating permanent, like, wounds in the forest, and he was, like, extremely detrimental to, like, the fabric.
Okay, wait, how the fuck do you injure the force?
Oh, the force can be injured all the time. That's how you make red lightsabers.
Well, yeah, I thought, like, yeah, but it...
Okay, think about the force is like a body, right? So normal,
it was like essence of existence.
Think of all of existence. We are all one body in Christ.
Right. Why'd you get religious on me?
So let's say there's there's a wound, a sickness in the body, right? That sickness is one of these dark entities, but normally the trauma works itself out and it heals. But this instance is not healing, it's bleeding out and out, almost like a cancer or a deeper sickness.
Is the idea that you're on a ticking clock until the force runs out?
No.
No.
You rejoin the force, it's recycled. It's kind of like how Earth is like, you could consider it, some religions consider it one living thing because, like, you know, pollution hurts it and it gets, like, hurt.
And when we die, we get absorbed back into the Earth, like in Star Wars, when you die, you get absorbed back into the force.
Yeah. But no, Dark Nihilus was not a, you know, a balanced scale. He was extremely dangerous and very destructive to, like, the habitat of just the universe itself.
Sure, but maybe the universe needed that. That needed the cleansing.
They didn't.
Well, who's to say except the Force?
The Force definitely knows.
Hey, dude, cut off my finger.
Wait, what?
Me being the Force. Bro, cut off my finger. I need it gone.
Okay, now I need it back.
That's never gonna heal? Nah.
The Force is anti-finger. Yeah. Shannon.
Fuck this finger.
He's...
Yeah. Liam, something you were saying about, like, all life fighting for existence a while ago reminds me, I saw this video of, like, cells under a microscope.
Yeah.
And there was this one that was, like, being eaten, and while it was going into the other cell, it was, like, fighting and struggling and trying to puncture the sides until it finally stopped moving and was dead. And it was such
it's
a, like...
It's not dead. It's alive in the other cell. They amassed.
That's a Jedi way of thinking about it.
Yeah, well, no doubt. We're talking about Star Wars.
Star Wars.
Be prepared.
When you're fighting the cat. Star Wars.
So, Lord, how did you say you would pronounce it?
Why don't we just look up the pronunciation? Name again?
Can you show me the thing? Vitiate.
Lord Vitiate. So he was the illegitimate child of, like, a Sith noble back when there was a giant Sith empire, right?
Oh, yeah, back then.
So he was dumped off in some backwater planet with his servant mom.
Dagobah.
And it wasn't Dagobah, but I forget what it is. The planet doesn't exist anymore. It was Eden. You can guess why, yeah. And so...
Damn, that's kind of like a erase my trauma moment.
It's kind of like a caterpillar eating its own egg.
It is an erase my trauma moment. I wonder if caterpillars have a hatred of their egg and that's why they eat it.
No,
probably not.
It's just because, like, it's food there. Like,
yeah,
they eat it.
They don't think of... Caterpillars can't feel hate.
I'm sure they can feel
hate.
I'm
sure everything... Young me, when I was very young, I was not scared of trees because I was well aware that they could not move or speak. But I believed that they did hate us and they were endlessly filled with hate. But, like, we were in no real danger.
Huh.
Yeah, I mean, like, animals like bulls and, like, will hold grudges. Even, like, bees.
Well,
like,
those are more complex.
Those
animals,
are more complex
though.
Than, like, you know.
You're saying that bees are more worthwhile of hate? Like, bees deserve to feel hate. Caterpillars don't?
Yeah, you got a good point. That's pretty, like, racist of you.
Well, I don't think... Okay, I think a bull feels hate. I don't think a bee feels hate.
They do. They like
hold grudges.
That's not the same as feeling the emotion of hatred.
Who are you to say that they are not feeling it?
Are you a biologist, Tyler?
Are you a bee?
Are you taking AP biology? I didn't think so.
You're right, I couldn't pass AP biology.
How many times have you watched the bee movie? You don't know.
I want to be a bee!
How many times have you screwed with bees to make sure that they feel pain and anger? I know I have.
I towed the bee so that they can feel pain and they can feel emotions, but only the bad ones.
Oh, that's wonderful, Shannon.
The wings off of the bee one time, it came back to its
rendering. You sound like God when he makes schizophrenic people.
Oh.
I ripped the wings and legs off a bee one time to make it angry. It got rescued by its brothers. It came back cybernetic, and with this time, it tried to attack me. It lost its stinger to me, and then it ran away. Once it lost its stinger to me, it came back with like a pin and like injections and started killing me again.
It injected him with heroin and gave him a long-standing addiction.
Cybernetic bees, they evolved to put heroin in humans so we stay away from their nests, but it gets
it does the opposite, really. It makes us go to them.
All of Baltimore huddles around the bee nest.
It keeps you, like, the rest of the bees hold you down and, like, they knock you out.
You would
have
to.
And then it keeps you knocked out through the process of being high, so you only wake up with withdrawal symptoms.
Yeah, you would have to automate that process, because there's no way, like, a bunch of science. There's no way a mad scientist would have, like, that much time willing to spend, like, a year working, like, dead. Like, just, like, doing these advanced, like, cybernetics on, like, a bee. Like, do you know how many bees you'd have to do that to even make, like, a pocket-sized swarm?
Well, in the future, bees will do that to themselves.
Well, you're saying that, like, I mean, yes, they have brains, but, like, you'd have to automate this process. They're not going to get the machines, the parts themselves.
Future bees will. Future bees will.
They don't have fingers. How are they supposed to do it? They might be smart enough, but they're not going to have the mobility or hands to do it.
Actually, wait one second. You know how hermit crabs are making shells out of, like, cell phones? Phone parts in
Kermit
Hong Kong.
Crabs?
I didn't know that. I know they use like bud cans, and I remember somebody armed one.
Yeah, that's what
Kermit
bees are gonna
crabs?
Do. They're gonna pick up our leftover machinery and build cybernetic parts.
I think raccoons are gonna get there first.
I agree.
They're gonna beat the bees.
Imagine being a bee that was granted this like awful cybernetic half existence from a human being and they just keep doing it. And for what? For no reason. The bees are fine.
Not
would you
anymore.
Hate? Here is where the bees are allowed hate.
No, what ends up happening is first, it's just gonna do it's just gonna be evolution. First, the flowers start, like, growing metal, like, harnesses around them, just like how some insects grow metal teeth. And all of a sudden, they're gonna start growing, a welding material so that they can pierce through it, and then like the flowers are gonna start growing, like, lasers to shoot at the bees, like, anti-air. And then, like, the bees are gonna start learning to use, like, evasive maneuvers. And it's just gonna be...
Back to the heroin bees, though.
Oh my gosh.
I mean, that would not work out in their
Tyler,
favor.
Yeah, Tyler, what about the heroin bees?
I mean, in nature, like, bears, they'll go after that stuff all the time because it's like, you know, it's sugar. That's a lot of, like, calories right there.
The
heroin, you're just gonna immediately get addicted to it, and then where are you gonna go? To the beehive, obviously. It's just gonna attract more predators.
No,
but
here's what you do. You know how bees crowd around a predator and overheat it to death? The bees
like,
all surround
yeah,
the thing and sting it, and it'll overdose.
That's a lot of, like, calorie consumption with heroin. At that point, what you would want to do is just, like, one of those medication drug things.
Overdose
instead of just
the fucking bears.
I mean, like, at this point, what would you do is, like... I mean, bees die when they sting you, usually. So what would happen is bees would just become, like, cyanide pills on wings, and they'd fly into things instead. It's a lot less work.
Well, no, I think they would just sting you, and then you would, like, lose energy and not want to mess with the beehive anymore. And this evolution would
be... they keep you asleep through the course of the high.
I think that this would be a very advantageous adaptation for bees, because humans would notice this and keep them alive.
Hey,
and
bees,
the most advantageous adaptation in nature is to be appealing to humans in the 21st century.
Well,
if you
they
look
already
cute,
still
the people
are. Like, we still farm them. They're protected by, like, the government because they make honey.
And do you think bees would be alive if they weren't valuable to humans?
I mean, they wouldn't be over here, but, like, we can't really wipe them out as easily. Like, roaches, some
we're roaches actively keeping them alive. We're protecting them from pollution.
Well, well, we're keeping certain bees alive. We don't, there's a lot of bee types. We're keeping the honey ones alive.
It makes sense to keep something purposefully alive, if it benefits you, and to not make that effort if it doesn't. Like, I don't think that makes you morally apprehensible.
No, but that we're so powerful that we are the environment animals adapt around. Isn't that sick?
Yeah, I do like that idea.
I don't think about it. Anyways, Vitiate?
Do you have anything to say before we continue with the story of Vitiate?
If I did, I forgot it.
So, he was an illegitimate child, right? And so he started developing force abilities when he was six, and his father suddenly became suspicious that his mother had an affair. And so he confronted her on it and started screaming her and like...
Is the force genetic?
Yes.
Yeah, it is.
And he was grabbing a pan and about to beat her.
A pen?
A pan.
Oh.
And so Lord Vitiate just used the force and cracked his neck and threw his body to the side. And then his mom said, "What have you done?" And he said, "Oh, I'm not done with you, woman. You have failed growing this noble in this pathetic house, marrying this pathetic man." And then with the force, he tortured her for 3 days. And then he...
What kind of philosophy, what was in the raising of this child to bring up that philosophy?
That's odd, because usually the Sith, like, one of the initiations, like, you have to kill a loved one. Like, many of them, they kill their girlfriends, but, like, they kill, like, girlfriends or their wives or something.
According to traditional Sith religion, which I know way too much about, to become a true Sith master, one of your early trials is to kill your entire family. But true members of the Sith don't ever have to be told this. They're called to it by their nature.
Yeah, but the thing is like, you have to, like, have a good connection with them to where you love them, or, like, it's hard to do it. Like,
so we're talking about a doomsday.
Yeah, but, like, this guy, like, it wasn't hard at all. He didn't really love them, so, like, that's odd to me, right? Like...
Well, maybe he... Yeah, what had to happen to this six-year-old to make him like this? Because when he was born, he probably loved his mother, like, biologically, right?
Yeah.
There are people who can be born without that sort of capability.
I mean, yeah.
So I guess, do you think that makes him not a true Sith? By being a sociopath?
I think that Sith is an inherently dumb title.
I stole that.
That's worse. That's worse.
So anyways, after he tortured his mom to death, he went around and just used force powers to enslave his town and eventually his continent. Mm. Now, this is a backwater world, right? Uh-huh. But eventually he raised a big enough army to start sending out spaceships and, like, colonizing. And so his actual father, the Sith Lord in charge of the solar system, was like, okay, this is a real problem now, let me go deal with it. And so...
He was like, he was six when he began.
Yes.
So this man is like 11.
He's 10.
Oh, like Genghis Khan.
Yes, a lot like Genghis Khan, actually. I think Genghis Khan was one of the inspirations.
No, Genghis Khan was inspired, don't you know? Because that took place in a long time.
You're right. But anyways, so his father came down, and Lord Vitiate, as a 10-year-old, used the force to absorb his father's force powers.
I mean, that is the next step. You kill...
you kill your mother and absorb your father.
No, the like, thing is just,
ye
like...
Oedipus.
Damn, that was not a level of analysis I was ready for.
What's Oedipus?
It's an old play about a guy who fucks his mom.
But what I was gonna say was that, like, you're talking about, this is before the rule of two, right? This is like,
yeah, this is before
so the that's rule really two. Odd, because, like, that was also another step in the rule of two. You obviously, you know, there's apprentice, there's a master, eventually the apprentice kills the master, so that would make sense that he kills his father. Like, oh yeah, I've succeeded you. But this is still before rule of two, so it's odd, you know?
It is a little odd.
It happened a lot, but, like, it's funny how well he's sticking to the tradition before it happens.
Well, I think Bane... Okay, this is a really weird metaphor, but think of... The rule of two was invented by Sith Lord Bane, mm-hmm. and I think of Sith Lord Bane as, like, the Martin Luther of the Sith religion. Mm. He came and, like, reformed it and brought it closer back to its original principles.
What was its original principles?
The strong deserve what they have, and the weak deserve to die, essentially. And, like, we deserve to be... If we can take it from you, we will, because we deserve it.
Yeah, it was like a worship
That's like an actual... That's one of the base philosophies of fascism, Nazism, isn't it?
Do you remember the Empire? When it was the first, like, Star Wars...
Oh, yeah, thing. Space Nazis. Also, I thought you meant Martin Luther King Jr., and not just Martin Luther. And I was like, how the hell is there an MLK of the Sith? When, like, in private, you don't.
Yeah, you can edit it.
Alright, so Lord Viavate strips his father of his power, and now his father's like a helpless man who's never been without the Force before, right? He was a noble, used to power.
Well, isn't the Force the thing that brings life? You just cut
his connection with it.
I was about to say no, like you cut the like religious umbilical cord.
Yeah. That's a really funny way of saying it. So now his father's on the ground like begging for his life, right? And the kid laughs, tortures him for 3 days, and then kills him.
Oh, I would have totally let him live, because, like, the thing is, it's just, there's this movie where it's like, one thing the most rich people hate is being poor. Because it's like, no, if you kill him, you end his suffering way too soon. You let him live without his power. You let him, like, grovel at, like, beggars. You let him be a beggar, and then the beggars he, like, kicked over get to kick him. You know? Like, he gets to, like, feel everything, you know?
So after this, Lord Vivate talks to like the higher up Siths, takes his respective position on the council. Remember when I said this was going to be a 1 minute thing, Shannon?
Yeah.
He takes his higher He took his higher seat on the council, and then he like quietly studied. He was very academic for 300 years. This was 10-year-old. When he was 10, he had a vision of the future and saw that if I want to rule the galaxy, I need to wait for the right moment. So he just slowly conquered and tortured his people, absorbing their energy for 300 years.
He was a human.
He'd been on that grind set.
Well, he started out...
Imagine if Andrew Tate was a Sith Lord.
Kind of is the thing.
Yeah.
Also, I love that shot of the window.
It's like instead of Bugattis, he's got like 10 Death Stars of different colors.
And so then 300 years later, he does conquer the galaxy, but he's defeated by some Jedi with plot armor who are related to him.
Good for him.
And that's the story of Lord Vivate, like a real Sith, as compared to the other things in this lecture. Heroin bees are kind of Sithy, I don't know.
It's hard to say, because, like...
Heroin bees seem more Stormtrooper-y.
Yeah. Did they always miss?
They sound like Combine to me. I really want to see, like, the Combine, like, interact with, like, the Empire.
Yeah, the
and,
idea
like...
of, like, getting... cybernetic'd beyond your will, beyond what your mind is capable of comprehending.
Dark troopers.
For someone else's idea of what you should be, and then they fucking give you heroin.
Isn't that kind of like what Darth Vader is?
That's kind of a cosmic horror.
Yeah, Darth Vader was really cool as a I love his concept and like what he became.
Half of this lecture is about Darth Vader.
Nice.
The other half is about bees.
The bee movie.
The secret empire planned to make heroin bees to get Luke addicted.
This movie was deeply inspired by Star Wars. George Lucas gave it a pass.
Wait, what?
Huh? You
the bee
know?
Movie was inspired by Star Wars?
You didn't know?
I didn't.
Whoa.
You're making this shit up.
I ain't. You can look it up.
Yeah, you look it up and then put it in the video if it's true. Like, edit in some articles. Can you do that for me?
I'm not gonna do that.
Hey, Tyler, Photoshop an image of a bike right here.
I'm not
and gonna... put my face on the wheels.
Hey, Tyler, edit this part out for what I'm about to say.
Hey, Tyler, give me a heroin bee. Swarm around the screen.
No heroin for anyone in this family, not allowed.
Do you guys
I
have coke?
I want the bees.
Is meth okay?
In the small amounts.
Instead of, like, Coke versus Pepsi, it's Coke versus meth. Like, you know, like a drug dealer. Like, you got any cocaine? Is meth okay?
Thank you, Stoner brother. Schizophrenic.
Stoner is not cocaine and meth. That is something different.
All right. You tell me what it is.
Stoners are like, they're like a, you know, you're chill or like, you're kind of like a statue in a way because like, you're just very like, not movie and you're just kind of like sitting there just think like meth and cocaine, you're just like jittery and whatnot. You're
like
just
a bee.
Yeah.
Like y'all a have... Sith Lord. Like a bee, like a Sith Lord.
Cocaine bear, Sith Lord.
Do y'all have anything else to say to Shock You? All 400 something subscribers.
For the Emperor.
Oh, good job on 400, Tyler.
Thank you.
Man, how many of those people are your alternate accounts?
Nope.
How many, did you go around on, are you the person that goes around on YouTube posting links like, here, you should watch this, in like the replies of comments?
You will wait for the day where I am there to make it better.
Are you alluding to the Shannon lecture?
Yeah.
You know what? This could this would be great podcast, but also just like I feel like I know there. This might be a good when you're filming us like this. I don't know if it looks that great, but like it would probably look better. And like I've seen a lot more of these types of things, but it's like done over Discord, so it and it looks.
Don't Discord us.
I've done some Discord Shocky You things before. I feel like Shocky You is listenable content.
It is. It's essentially a podcast.
But occasionally you see people's faces, like when a joke's funny, like you rewind 10 seconds and look at how people reacted.
You do that?
That's what I do with my, like...
Imagine looking.
That's what I did with the PCP lectures, which is what Shocky You's are ripping off of.
What's PCP?
The drug or the PCP lectures?
Well, which one? I don't know either one.
Nope, Shannon. Sorry, I was about to say something dumb.
You're about to say something not canon.
Shannon's just like, Shannon, my name, my address, my home, they just...
Yeah, everyone come visit us in Baltimore, Maryland.
Visit me in Baltimore! I am Shannon!
Who would win in a fight, Batman or Darth Vader?
That depends. So,
it depends on who's writing Batman.
What's your take there, Shannon?
I mean, a lot of times Batman is,
I think
is
it's
like,
always a, it's gonna be a draw.
No, one second.
Batman is always, like...
Prepared.
Yeah, that's his thing. He's, like, crazy prepared. So, does he know that he's fighting Darth Vader? Either way, like, Darth Vader can, like, do the thing where he, like, snaps your neck. So, I don't know.
I don't know if he knows that force power, but what I was gonna say is, like... Darth Vader, what you gotta remember is he's a lot of cybernetics, and,
well,
like, EMPs or water or whatever, like, Darth Vader could probably figure that out soon and then use that to, like, you know, all of a sudden he's EMP'd Vader and, like, half his body is just fallen over and his life support's off and he's gotta, like, try to find a way to, like, he stops fighting and he uses the Force to save his own body
the
for a while.
The other thing is that Darth Vader is a very sad, self-hatred-fueled man who hates the... evil that he has become. So
I don't know if he hates
Batman,
but so is Batman.
Batman isn't evil.
Yes, he is.
No. So what you can do is that,
I mean,
like,
if you
he
saw
can
a
talk
news article.
He can talk Vader onto his same side,
I
where
don't.
It's Batman going, join me.
Actually, that seems like the most realistic.
Yeah.
Actually, you're right, because one of the main things is,
Batman's
like...
Batman's a diplomat.
Well, yeah, but also, Anakin has never fully
diplomat.
Converted to the dark side. Like, he never visits Tatooine again because it can reawake Anakin in him.
Huh.
And, like, his video... Sidious talks
is
about this at some
point.
Is
that why the other Sith... Is that why the fucking man, he ate his house?
Like, Sith... Like,
yeah, he probably did eat his house so he could never return to his former weaker self.
There's also, like, let's not forget, like... In the books, like, Sidious talks about, like, how when he got overthrown by Vader, he's like, it's not when a monster overthrows his creator, it's because, it's not the monster's fault, it's the creator for not making a good monster. Because he never, because Sidious was, like, a bad, like,
He was a bad Victor Frankenstein.
Because, well, he was,
Victor Frankenstein was fucking awful!
Well,
yeah, that was,
like,
the entire point, he was bad at what he did.
But Palpatine, like, he was always in it for himself, and all Sith Lord are, but he never followed traditions, he was all in, like,
He didn't train his apprentice to kill him. He stunted his growth.
Not even to kill him or anything. He was like, he was always trying to be in control and immortality. And like, other Sith try that, but like, they always like, are interested in the Dark Lord. They're always interested in the Sith, in the, like, themselves, but also the Sith.
Passing on the true Sith.
Yeah, and Palpatine was not into passing on the Sith, like, torch. And so, like, he made sure that, like, Darth Vader was vulnerable to stuff like electricity so that he could be like, you can't attack me, I'm using you as my pawn. And he did that with, like, and he made sure, like, Count Dooku was that way. He made sure he could fight him.
And when Darth Maul got too powerful, he kicked him out.
Yeah, well, he didn't. Darth Maul just died.
That happened later when Darth Maul returned.
Prophecy father archetype.
What do you mean?
Kronos eating his children.
Whoa.
They were stated to overthrow him.
Oh, yeah.
Anyways, the idea of, like, when you then kill the Sith Lord... Sorry.
It's alright.
No, follow this train of path Kronos before we get back to Luna. I'm curious.
I was just leaving it there.
Oh, keep going.
When you kill the Sith Lord, if the idea is, like, in classic Sith nature, you kill your upper, and that's how you become true Sith, whoever killed him probably had some shit to deal with. Of, like, oh no. And that's probably the thing. Your death is a power play if you're killed by an enemy.
Nah, I don't think so.
I don't follow that.
She's saying, like, it's like
how... No, I can rephrase.
No, you can't.
Let the woman speak.
God forbid women do anything these days. Anyways,
Don't use the Lord's name in vain.
God forbid women do anything these days. so, if the idea is, in Sith nature, one of the things you do is kill your family to become better, and also one of the, like, signs of ascension in Sithhood is you kill your upper, right?
Yeah.
Then, if you are the head of the Sith Nation, and you get killed by someone who is a, philosophical enemy.
Yeah.
To you. Your death is a power play.
For them, not for you.
For you.
How?
You're killing me to be, and now you are one of me. You've finished the step of killing,
The higher-up.
You
like,
have done it.
Doesn't the Emperor tell Luke to kill him, and then you will become me? Or doesn't
he
say that to
Rey? No, he tells him to kill Vader. He was gonna get a new apprentice.
Right.
Or younger and stronger.
He tells Rey to kill him in episode 9, though.
In
your anger.
I didn't watch that one.
Yeah, you will... You're just gonna be me.
Well, also...
You might hate me, but you are completing the steps.
True.
Your death is a power play.
That makes a lot of sense. Thank you for explaining that, Shannon.
Also, again... Do you understand the Kronos eating his children thing?
Oh, deeply.
Yeah, okay.
Now, let's see if I can remember what I was talking about earlier. So, at what point
heroin
were we...
Beams.
Oh, yeah. So, like, Anakin never really lived the dark side because of that. He would, like, in comics or sometimes, like, there's this one person that worked with him at one point. He was kind of... Like, one of those admirals or something.
Yeah, yeah.
And, like, he was a real family man. And, like, Anakin... And Vader respected that. And, like, in the comic, you get to see a bit of Anakin where, like, he saves him with, like, a force healing power. And, like, he gets... And then the admiral gets to go home at some point afterwards. And he gets to, like, be with his family again. And so, like, Anakin could have been, like... Because this is all about Batman negotiating with Vader. Because... Vader could probably be turned to the right side, because Luke did it at the end.
Yeah.
And it's all because, you know, Sidious is a bad Dark Lord, because he doesn't continue the dark side, it's always for him, and so, you know, it's just like, he's incapable of making a good,
Here we turn back to the inherently corruptive nature of power. And the inherently selfish way of having it.
So, I guess that's kind of a self-defeating issue with the Sith religion.
Yes. It is... In its structure and its philosophy, it is flawed and self-defeating, and that is why it always fails.
Yeah. That is indeed true.
The Sith is a pyramid scheme.
It is, but that's a lot of things. That's also, like, that's also pretty much a commentary on the... I can't remember things that are like that in real life.
I guess most fascist regimes are pyramids games.
You know, I never really thought about that.
Yeah.
What are you doing?
It's, what's funny though is Darth Vader basically became a Jedi after he became a Sith. Because, like, you know, his whole, like, Jedi career, he was, like, he was making relationships with Padme, that's a no-no. He was, like, had feelings, that was a no-no.
So
he, like,
Anakin
had all these different times.
Was never dead inside Skynet.
Vader, definitely not. But you're right, he never was a true Jedi.
And then what happens after he becomes Sith, like, oh, he doesn't want to have relationships. He doesn't like family relationships, friendship relationships. He's, like, totally cut off. Like, he wants
Vader
emotionally.
Vader was never dead inside Anakin, either.
Yeah.
Which I think is another statement on the human condition.
Well, also, he was the chosen one. Brings balance. He was the balance. He was both.
He was Anakin.
That's
he was
force.
Vader.
In this universe, the Force is the duality, the human condition. Inside everyone, you are Anakin, but you are also Darth Vader.
Okay, and you know another thing that's more of like... So the Jedi are always in service of the Force, right?
Well, some Jedi.
And
Jedi are paladins, yes.
Darth Sidious, the Emperor, is said to be a perfect black hole, a perfect mirror of the dark side.
And...
So Darth Vader, by obeying him, is following through with the Force. In some sense, he is a Jedi, you know, obeying the Force unquestioningly, not having relationships.
Yeah, and then, like, what the thing was, after that whole thing happens, because, like, Sith haven't been in power for, you know, who knows how long, it's too long to count, really.
Does this make sense? Because, I mean, in that idea of the perfect Jedi, you were abstaining from deep relationships or friendships and principledness... But then you're washing out the color in the existence of the Force. Maybe I'm getting real.
No, that's part of the flaw of the Jedi.
So there is no perfect.
The Sith and Jedi are both flawed. We gotta build a new order.
What I was gonna say is, like, so, yeah, when I was talking about earlier, though, like, how Darth Vader basically became a Jedi, like, after the Sith have taken over Darth Sidious, you know, it's been so long since the Sith have ever been in power again, that, like, one of the things is just, like, what do we do? It's like how, when you play a video game, you rank up all the way, and you're like, well, now what? Because I've got everything. So, like...
More! More!
Well, yeah, but once you have everything and you can't get more, what do you do? And so, one of the things was, like, to learn about Sidious, he was always one of those, like, thrill chasers when he was young. Like, he loved speed racing on bikes and what, all those, like, speeder bikes and whatnot. But as he grew in being diplomatic, he still had other things. Like, in the episode where he... In, like, the third episode... Sorry, or is it... the eighth episode.
Of?
Star Wars, you know, when he, like, dies to Vader, you know, in the Death Star. There was
so
a reason
Vader
he was watching...
Superior.
Vader does kill him, yeah.
That's interesting... Sorry.
Yeah, I know, you've been doing that a lot, but I think I might have done that a lot.
No, that's how Shocking You works.
Symbolic yeah. Human here. He is neither Jedi nor Sith. He's both at the same time.
Yeah, he
time
fulfills both legacies.
Constantly. He is never either. And he's always, like, fully... Like, he is some of the most fully human character here. That's based.
Isn't Star Wars kind of cool?
Yeah, that's... Shit, that's cool, yeah.
That's shit. But, I can't remember what I was talking about.
Damn.
Oh, Lord Vader.
Oh, yeah.
Killing Vader. The Emperor.
That wasn't it. But it was like, you know, Sidious is always a thrill chaser. And so,
yeah.
Like, in that episode, you see he's, like, in the throne room in his Death Star, and he's out looking at a window, and he's looking at the fight of the Rebels and the Empire. Like... He was still having the thrill of the moment being there because he's watching this battle, but he's also so close to it. Like, he could be attacked, but, like, he's living... That's why he also let Darth Vader and Luke fight in front of him. It was the thrill of being near danger.
Or why his throne room has all these, like, pits to fall in. He likes being near the edge, feeling alive.
That's still cowardly.
But also, like, what I was gonna say is, like, Darth Sidious, he, like... He enjoyed the fine things in life because he could. Like, he loved poetry. He made books about how, like, he hates the light side because... Yeah, basically, he was, like, talking about, like,
the Force is an evil being because it controls us and, like, wants us to choose our fate. And being Darkseid, you use it against itself. And that's, like, the best thing you can do. And, like, he had Jedi that were captured fight each other. And then if they agreed to, like, work underneath him, he'd let them live. Or, like, you know, he loved doing all these extravagant things, eating great food, you know, reading great poetry and all this types of stuff, artsy stuff and whatnot. Darth Vader, however, he just went back to, like, he would basically live in isolation. He would, like, work on his lightsaber, work on his fighting techniques, and just practice and meditate. And it's funny, because as a Sith, he was more Jedi than when he was a Jedi.
That's so cool!
He had everything, and then he chose not to have it.
That's the humanity there. He was never either. The other thing is, if he was supposed to be the perfect reverse of the Force, he was still doomed to fall. It's the idea that their philosophy was too narrow-minded, too focused
on the self. Who are you talking about, Vader or the Emperor?
The Emperor. It's too focused on the self to be sustainable, so the complete inverse of the Force was still doomed to fall.
Yeah!
That's cool. That's
he fell just like Lord Vivate fell before him, because Star Wars is mythology that echoes and rhymes in itself.
It's quite mythology. It's very... It is very, by this nature of it won't work.
Yin-yang.
Yeah.
What were you saying, Liam? Also, that yin-yang comparison was really good.
I don't think that's basically what it is, but,
I don't think they need each other.
No, they don't, but that's essentially what it is in Star Wars. Let me see.
An inverse of the Force will never be sustainable. But people want to assume that they can do it on their own, and they can't, and they fall.
What I was going to talk about is, like, also in the prequels, like, the specific antagonists are all, like, precursor, like, it's like a foreshadowing of Vader, and they talk about it, because Maul was the anger, the raw Force power that Darth Vader would have. General Grievous is the cyborg and the loss of humanity that he becomes. And Count Dooku is the wisdom,
the cleverness,
style, the cleverness, and
the
whatnot.
Creativity that you really see Anakin demonstrate in the Clone Wars show.
Yeah, but and like also like Count Dooku was still someone that like had some good in him and was like trying to fight for a cause. And so it's all those three: the anger of Maul, the loss of humanity and cybernetics of Grievous, and the of the humanity and like intelligence of Dooku and fight style.
Those are really good points. What was that, Shannon?
He, the Emperor, was still none of it.
You said something about the Emperor being a coward. I have a earlier addendum about that, but can you go on that thought?
Well, he used to be a thrill racer. Like, he would race, he would, whatever it was you said he would do. Yeah, but then But then when he became into power, he was like, oh, I'll just be here and look at the fight.
Well,
and he was still getting the thrill of I'm in danger. He isn't engaging in the battle, but he's deluding himself into thinking he's this great brave whatever because I could get hurt.
Well, the big thing is actually,
and that's like that's less honor than the photographers going to Vietnam.
Well, what I want to say is, like, I left out some parts. Like, he was a royal, and so he wasn't allowed to do all the things he wanted to do. And so eventually, like, as he was forced and conditioned, like, he basically, like, he wouldn't participate in these things, but he would still find ways that were, like, kind of like that, but kind of acceptable. Like, watching gladiatorial combat or, like, being near war.
That's still cowardly. He started the war. He could go out on the battlefield. If he wanted to fight, he could fight.
If he was a Sith Lord, he exerts his will upon the world. If he wanted to fight, he could.
Yes, but it's also his appearance. But what
it's like the...
I was going to say, it's like a Darth Sidious. Man, I can't remember what I was going to say. You say it.
Okay, it's still the, like, he's now out of the nest. He's still rich, but he can do whatever the hell he wants. He still chooses not to engage in the fight. He still, oh, I got this adrenaline rush from being near here. Like, that's still cowardice pretending it's honor and bravery.
Yeah, I think what Liam is saying is what the Emperor tells himself, but this reminds me of how the Emperor brags about he's the greatest Sith because he killed all the Jedi. The Emperor has not killed any Jedi.
Oh, he did. But the thing was...
He sent his little bitch Darth Vader to do it for him.
Most of the clones at first, yeah.
He brags that he killed...
I'm sure you could read into that symbolically, though. You need the humanity to get anything done.
But what I was also gonna say was, like, Darth Sidious always loved to fight his opponents politically. That was his favorite, like,
because he's
them.
A little bitch and can't actually win physical fights.
If you listen to me. So... He used his, when he had lightsabers, like, he doesn't like lightsabers because he feels like they're, like, he's like, that's pissy work. You should be able to fight with your force because you're that powerful. But he did make his lightsabers because it was an insult to the Jedi. He used, like, a very rare and, like, symbolic metal that was supposed to only be given to you if you did something.
Huh.
And he just used it and made his things basically jewelry pieces. And he hid them in his room so that whenever the Jedi did end up seeing them, they'd be like, this whole time, he's basically able to, he was able to make these amazingly pieces of, he was able to make these amazing pieces of our culture while he was disguised in front of us. And it was like an insult to injury because, like, it's like,
it's a power move.
Yeah, because, like, the Jedi are supposed to be pretty humble. So ordaining a Jedi's, like, the most iconic thing about them being their lightsaber and making it, like, a show is very, like, mean because it's, like, you're not humbling it. You're taking their humble thing and making it, like, extravagant.
But isn't that a very Emperor way of hiding your cowardice? You feel fear of something, and so you turn it into this, I'm so great, look at me, I have this saber, and I'm better than all of them, ha ha ha.
I think so, but, like, again, it wasn't that... The reason he loved doing it politically, because he got to crush them with, like, everything else, like... He got to get the population to hate them if he won. He got to do it with their... He got to beat them with their own rules. He didn't have to resort to what they would call savagery so that he could, like, be like, I'm great because even in your own Jedi ways, I could still beat you.
That's the thing, though. It's all Emperor's new clothes. He's relying on the fear of the people so that they don't show him... That he is a man without pride nor honor.
No, not the fear of the people. He basically used the people to crush the Jedi. He did that.
He needs them to fear him and to hate him so that he doesn't realize how much of a prideless coward he is.
No, yes. He actually made them love him. They all were like, they loved him.
They loved him presenting, which is another form of fear. Which the Emperor feeds off of, like, well, maybe, Lord Vivate,
like,
fed off planets.
It was more so, like, how Hitler would be, like, how his group
Hitler
loved him
coward.
At first, you know? Like, you
Hitler
know, like...
Coward.
Yeah, but...
He killed himself.
Saying,
only cowards do that. Listen, I'm allowed to say it. I tried once, and I was a coward at the time.
Yeah, but what I was gonna say is, like, yeah, like, the people that he originally worked with, they loved him. Once he became in the Empire, there was more controversy. But, like, when he was first starting out, he was like, the Jedi are these evil people, and look, I've been getting rid of them, and look at how great I'm making this population.
Yeah.
And also, he's basically... The best way I could say when he's talking about politics and beating people with it, it's like cancel culture. He's using, like... He's not using the fear of the people. He's making the Jedi fear
the
people because the people... He's sicking the people on them, essentially.
It's an interesting metaphor.
I can't see the, like... I can't wash the Andrew Tate out of that in my brain.
Yeah, I still love Andrew Tate. Andrew Tate as a Sith Lord.
Okay. Okay. Right.
How many speeders do you have? I've got 15 Death Stars in my garage.
Do you have anything else to say to shock you, Shannon?
You're all cowards and you're going to implode.
Do you have anything else to say, Liam?
Go fuck yourself.
This has been Shock of You.
Vader and his team of Inquisitors land on Dagobah. They walk through the swamp,
sensing nothing. They want to go back, but Vader presses on. He knows. Slowly, one by one, homemade traps take them, unsensed in the Force. Vader orders his remaining Inquisitor back onto the shuttle. She disobeys. He shoves her in, pursues into the cave, knowing that's where Yoda must be hiding. He wanders in, deeper, feeling heat on his skin, burning, searing. His armor constantly is addressing painkillers, allowing him not to feel it. He can feel the cybernetics glitching, pausing as he goes deeper into the cave. He feels the armor vanish off of his skin. He's a young boy. He sees Watto in front of him, beating his mom, smiling. What are you gonna do about it, boy? Anakin is filled with anger. You can't fucking do that. He reaches for his lightsaber. He has no lightsaber. He's a kid. He punches Watto. Watto smiles, turns into the Emperor, shoots the boy with lightning. Vader is screaming and burns. And in this moment, a lightsaber enters his chest. Green. Weak. In his old age, Yoda has gotten resort to cleverness. He must. Vader was distracted, in pain, and then he was slain. There was no arc, no redemption, no forgiveness. Was it possible? Yes, but could Yoda take that risk? How many more younglings, Jedi, would be slain? If you are evil, you are not owed redemption. You can be snatched like that. Vader, in that moment, forevermore, is consumed in hatred and rage and suffering echoing on in that present eternity. Yoda won! He slew evil, and so, you know, he had to celebrate. But how do you celebrate? I mean, what do you even do on Dagobah? He fucked a swamp rat.